Really?
Yeah. Hello. Welcome to the Rooster Teeth podcast. This week brought to you by Braintree, Dollar Shave Club, and Rock Band 4. The fourth of the rock bands.
Kevin has a thick beard.
I'm Gus.
I'm a bit beardy, aren't I? I'm Gavin with a beard.
I'm Chris, no beard.
I'm Bernie with a beard.
And I'm Gus with almost no beard.
What happened to your beard?
It burned off. It's a beard accident.
Hey, everybody.
No, I had to shave it. We did a shoot the other day.
And Gus, you were just saying how you were worried because you don't have anything to talk about.
No, it's not that I don't have anything to talk about. I just feel like the podcast just started.
Like you feel unprepared?
I actually get this. Normally, every probably 10 episodes, I panic. I'm like, what are we going to talk about?
No, I've got plenty of things lined up. Just like I feel like it just started. Like I wasn't... Like I didn't sit here long enough ahead of time.
What number are we on now? Like
344, I believe.
344. In the history of the show, what do you think has been the longest pause? Barring when Chris is on the podcast, because Chris is here today.
You mean like between subjects?
Yeah, just like there's nothing to talk about.
I reckon 3 seconds.
We had some longer ones. It feels like early ones. I mean, we would do like 6 or 7 sometimes.
Our shoulder hurts. My shoulder hurts, and I think it's my neck is making my shoulder hurt.
Because of your
a referred pain.
I had a thing where
yes, Chris, you have your hand up.
Yeah. Well, no. Like my wrists would always hurt, and I thought it was carpal tunnel. Turns out it was my neck that was like really tight, and whenever I started stretching my neck and doing this, it stopped hurting my wrists.
Really?
Yeah.
I know a guy who got carpal tunnel because he did one season of data entry for the IRS, and had to have surgery. Like he had a job for like 3 months, a temp job.
Carpal tunnel is permanent. What physically is it? Is it like
carpal tunnel? Seems like it was a huge deal in about the mid 90s.
Is it different to RSI?
It's repetitive stress injury. No, it's the same. It's a class. It's one of the conditions that is a class of RSI. So RSI is like the big thing. I'm sure there's other stuff.
Carpal tunnel.
Is RSI repetitive stress injury?
Yes.
Is that what it is? So you get a repetitive stress injury like on your ankle. Carpal tunnel is very specifically the way a nerve goes through part of your hand, like through your wrist into your hand.
Like through pinches the nerve.
The carpal tunnel. Right. Exactly right. And then it gets inflamed, and then you get like tingling in your hand and all that stuff. But it does seem like a big deal. Like that was something we were all worried about.
They made special ergonomic keyboards and all that shit. Remember that?
Yeah.
I don't see that anymore. What happened?
No. You know what? I just saw one the other day. You know what it was?
It makes me mad. It makes me... No.
Whoa.
I'm going to talk about this for a second.
Go ahead.
You hit on a nerve.
No, a couple times.
Very good.
Yeah.
I feel like then we were scammed. Like, I mean, they made these special ergonomic keyboards, this shit that like spread apart in the middle. Why don't they make those anymore, Adam? Do we fix carpal tunnel? Is that not a problem?
Well, they're still not.
They still have them, and I'll use one sometimes.
Why?
Like a spread?
Because it's comfortable.
Keyboard?
I started using it whenever my wrists were hurt because I thought I had carpal tunnel.
No fucking way I would use one of those because I can't type.
You get used to it. You get used to it.
I don't know how to type.
Oh, yeah.
I just type like this. I'm embarrassed by that, but I have yet to solve that problem in my life.
You have point typed a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I use 4 fingers total. I use the first 2 fingers, and then in space bars, that.
So. What a space bar, like just this?
My
thumbs. What is the most, these days, what is the most efficient, like if they were to redo the keyboard, what would it look like?
If I'm going to
redone the keyboard.
They have like QWERTY and Dvorak.
I think it's just whatever anybody knows. But every time I come across an alphabetical keyboard that's in alphabetical order, it's just like, I get furious.
But would you prefer a keyboard where everything was perfectly aligned, like stacks? Because the only reason they're... So you got 2 here, and then the next key is like here.
I wouldn't care about that at all.
But that's because the typewriter
had to
like reach between keys, and they couldn't have the pins go under keys.
Sure, that makes sense, because it was a physical...
But would it be easier to type on a grid keyboard?
Yeah, probably. I mean, unless the offset is... It's hard to say.
The offset also helps you like get to multiple letters. Like if you reach up, you're in the middle between 2 letters, so then your one finger can easily hover between the 2.
It's like finger climbing.
They have another keyboard that's designed for the letters that you use the most, and it's people, their hands are just vibrating pretty much.
Dvorak, right?
Something like that, yeah.
I think that's what that is.
And they type really fast, and it's just this.
I mean, there's always different ones like that. I saw one years and years ago that was like a sphere that you held. And it was like, you would hold it like this, and you'd go like this, and then like moving your fingers outward also... was different keys, and like people who could use this could type, 25.
I want a crazy keyboard like that now,
like a sphere.
I was mad a second ago. Now I want a crazy keyboard.
You know what? I've relied on for years and years. That's just to me a lot easier. Is
a pen?
Dragon dictate.
Dragging dick
what?
Tape.
I heard dragging dick tape.
What did you say? A dragon dictate. You guys have never heard of dragon dictate?
I heard dragging dick tape.
You guys all know because I text you that I use Siri for like 90% of my
sucks.
Text.
I never know what you're talking about.
We're a technology company. Well, kind of, right? We use a lot of technology. day to day in our jobs.
We use it.
Speak for yourself.
And so, you know, people type. People can, you know, make notes on mobile devices like
this. What's wrong?
At our weekly meeting this morning, I saw our, she's our CFO. Our CFO had notes to talk about to everyone in the company. She had written them on her hand.
Yeah.
She just put stuff and written on her hand.
It's a very Yvonne thing to do.
I laughed out loud when I saw it. I've got a few things to talk about. I couldn't help. I just started laughing.
Does she have a phone?
She does have a phone.
Yeah.
She's got a laptop.
I believe Yvonne's title is COO, by the way.
COO?
Yeah.
Chief. Okay.
Cool.
And she's also got a pen and paper.
Hmm. Look, when your hand's right there, you're not going to lose it, to be fair.
It's true. You look at your hand all the time, just for fun, so...
I guess I've got sweaty hands, so I'm jealous of people who can actually write
on their
hand.
You see the text sliding down.
Yeah.
Are you guys hungry at all?
Yeah.
I was going to tell you guys not to eat pizza.
I did not have any pizza.
Oh, I already ate pizza.
So I want to do a little bit of housekeeping today, if I may, Gus.
All right.
First of all, in the past, I've talked about how I have a supply of emergency things at my house.
Which has to be a gimmick and is not actually for real use.
What does that mean?
There's no way you believe that one day you'll
need that. Have I ever brought you over to my house and shown you my emergency supplies?
I bought emergency supplies recently.
There you go.
Look who you're company with.
That's right. Responsible, mature adults. Dude, I have kids. Neither one of you guys have kids.
I don't have kids, but I...
Well, that's fine. You are a kid. So you need to be prepared.
What's the best that can happen? You keep your kids alive for an extra week, and then what?
What is wrong with you? Why would you even ask that question?
What does that mean?
As opposed to what? Just like, oh, the apocalypse, just open the front door and go out and play, you know, have fun, boot him in the ass. Yeah, you keep him alive as long as possible. The secret to surviving the apocalypse is not to live a really long time. It's just to outlive everybody else. And then
because
then
it gets easier?
It does. It gets easier. Because there's a whole big world out there full of supplies.
That actually makes sense now.
It does.
If you live 2 weeks longer than everyone else, easy pickings.
Yeah.
What do you think we get to apocalypse level? Like, what's an apocalypse? 50% of the people dying?
Anything over 50.
Are the lights super bright today? Am I crazy?
You're crazy.
Do we have new lights?
They're not saying anything.
To me,
no?
It's normal.
An apocalypse isn't just like people dying, but it's like society breaking down. There could be 10% of people dead, but if laws...
10% of people die in the world, Chris, society will break down.
Yeah.
10? I mean,
like,
10%?
What's that, like 700 million
people? One out of every 10 people die? Yeah, people will go apeshit. I mean, remember Katrina? I mean, a bunch of water got in the ground, and people started sniping at doctors and hospitals. Sure. That was crazy.
That's true.
Okay, so this is... speaking of Katrina... this is my, these are 5-year, shelf life rations, and they're meant to be kept in like a maritime environment. So you keep them on a boat. Mm-hmm. In fact, it's covered in warnings about how to use them on a boat. Like, never drink with seawater. So don't do that. Okay. Even if you mix the seawater.
So you're not following the rules by keeping them in a cupboard, probably.
That's just their use. And I use them. So they have a 5-year shelf life. These were manufactured.
What makes them specific to maritime then?
No, I think they're intended for that use. But no, there's not it's not like they're like 100 less calories on land or anything like that.
It's themed food.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like Red Lobster.
It has a mirror and a flotation device in it. It says, instructions for emergencies, life raft at sea. Eat one bar every 6 hours per person. Eat in small pieces, chew well.
So it's not like
other
an MRE.
Emergencies on land, eat one bar every 4 hours per person. Eat in small pieces,
chew well. Is it just cold? It's not like a chemical heater to cook the food. Like
I believe it's just bars. Like I'm going to open it. I've actually never tried these. These were manufactured about a year and a half ago, January of last year. So
they still have 4 more years.
So it's got these little things in it right here. This little nugget.
It looks like kind of like a granola bar or maybe like a part of a rice.
Individually wrapped. But this package here, so if you want to see, this is how big the actual package is. So this has, for reference, I'm holding something that's about a cube. What do you say, about 3.5 inches cube?
Probably more than that. Five?
So. Four? 4 inches cubed.
Five
inches cubed.
It's not five.
Four.
Stop.
It's four.
It fits in my hands.
4.5.
And it's got 3,600 calories in this thing. So these wafers are 200 calories each. So this would last you, if you ate 1,200 calories a day, which you wouldn't want to do, but you could survive on, this is three days of food, right here. This is everything you need besides water.
What's the flavor?
I don't know. I think it's survival flavored. Here you go. Have one of those. There you go. Nice catch, Gus.
Thank you.
Ooh, Gabby.
It reminds me of like marzipan.
Oh, it's bloody rock solid.
No, mine broke
they're pretty
apart
dense.
Instantly.
It does say to chew it well.
Can I take a bite?
I don't think you're going to see these at a coffee shop. Go for it,
don't
dude.
Eat into the mic.
So, are you allergic
to
anything, Chris?
God,
Chris, are you allergic to anything that I should know about?
No.
Are you allergic to the apocalypse?
What's the flavor?
Because this thing is like 20% histamine.
So why don't we just eat this crap?
Exactly right. So that's
like why mess around with sushi and stuff?
I'm doing the housekeeping on this thing because I talked about it previously.
Oh, see, bollocks. That's what I want to do.
Yeah, Gus, you're so annoyed by the apocalypse.
I'm so put out. I broke mine. Yeah, see? Apocalypse is fun and games until you break your wafer.
The last one I tried were like lemon, dense lemon bars.
All right, here we go. Finally opened it.
It just smells like a crappy shortbread.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. It smells got like maybe a coconut smell.
Mm-hmm.
Maritime.
No, I think there's a lot of coconut oil in it because it can pack a lot of calories in it.
That's not bad.
It's not bad. It's.
I mean, you'd be miserable in this.
It's like a bad cookie.
Yeah. It's like a cookie someone squished together.
It's not bad. It's like a mediocre cookie.
It's not bad.
No, it needs a bit of hot sauce or something.
I could live
hot
on this.
Hot sauce. I can live on this mm-hmm. if you had to.
So if you think push, like, push come to shove, I can live a couple weeks on this.
So for perspective, if you have, you know, 10 of these cubes, then you have a month of food. So a month of food would take up about this much room for somebody.
For one person.
A month of food. Get you through a month of,
that's
like, survival
awesome,
stuff.
Actually.
Yeah. That's all what right. I like about it.
So what do you, so when you shit.
Go ahead.
The stuff you eat always comes out as a smaller piece of shit than what you ate.
Yeah.
But nothing's ever bigger in shit form.
Yeah.
Speak for yourself.
Does it gain momentum on the way through or anything?
But like, if you ate all of that, how big? So that would last 3 days. Are you saying I would poo less than that in 3 days?
Yeah. You'd poo less than that in 3 days.
I want to eat this stuff all the time.
Yeah, because you just save time on pooing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you put out by pooing?
It's just annoying.
Well, this
annoying.
Is the stuff, you know, I, this is the stuff I eat all the time, which is now the 100% food, which is the replacement stuff.
You can so do you don't shaking. Eat food anymore?
I wouldn't say, no, I make sure I eat a little bit of solid food every day because I don't want to lose my ability to digest solid food.
But, yeah, I can see why you wouldn't want to lose your ability to digest food.
Yeah, I'm worried about that.
You go out for a meal with friends and die.
I don't want to reacclimate to food. So,
but I got a big bucket. It's
go
just
ahead.
A big bucket.
I
want to
hear,
like,
about Chris's big bucket.
No, I it was on Amazon. I was like, I want to have stuff. So,
okay.
And
go on.
And I was like, what can I do that will? I want something I can, like, take, either put in my car really easily, or just not, like, barricade the door and then live off my bucket. And, you know, it said it would feed a family, I think.
It's bucket living.
To walk around.
Did you eat the whole thing?
Like, yeah. I'm picturing, like, a piece of tape on the side of a bucket. This is, like, Chris's life bucket. And it's right by the door. And you're, like, looking up the window every now and then. You're like, is it the apocalypse? No? Okay.
Yeah.
Just you and me,
it?
Bucket.
And then you look out one day, it's on fire. You're like, all right, bucket, now's our time.
It's cool, though, because I also put, like, a little...
You're going to be laying starving in the gutter. Zombies chasing you or something. Radiation sickness. And here will be fucking Chris coming along with his bucket. And then you will apologize to him.
He'll be smiling, having a great day.
Gus put that entire, like, day's worth of food into his mouth. And now he can't swallow it.
The crumbs everywhere.
It does say chew it very well. What? It's like lambus bread.
Wait,
that's what it's
yeah,
like.
Yeah, it's exactly what
it's
like.
Chew it though.
But it's not as tasty, but it's good.
What if you had lambus bread?
Well, I mean, as described.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, what if you just snapped it off and swallowed it like a pill? Would it expand in your stomach or something? Why do you have to chew it so well?
I don't understand that.
I don't know.
It really turns into, like, a paste in your mouth.
Like, yeah. Surely, if you have something...
I think it's because it's like pure coconut oil, basically.
If you just had this appear in your stomach, surely you'd be... It would last longer because your stomach would have to break it down.
No, but it'd use more calories. Well, I don't know. It might use more calories breaking it down in your stomach versus chewing
so
it up
might,
in your
like,
mouth.
So you might, like, lose energy to...
Yeah, maybe.
But then you have to use your muscles stomach. To
That's
chew,
true.
Though. Mm. Yeah, it's like, which costs more?
Right.
Imagine mashing it up with a hammer. No, that's energy in your hand. Damn it.
Running it over in a car.
Just eat your food. What are you guys doing in the... You guys are, like, running the most efficient apocalypse of all time.
We're just trying to make the food last longer. We're on your side.
But this stuff... I actually have gas masks, believe it or not.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That's
you know
good.
The model. Did you see the Model X came out from Tesla
mm-hmm.
and it has a biohazard button?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's
what's that for?
What is
it's to like air seal the car in case
what?
You like driving through a biohazard
that's
area.
That's so cool.
It's not cool. It's not cool.
That is cool though because you're like gonna you're gonna be like see a poison cloud and you're like, hang on guys,
go ahead.
I got this.
And then
drive right through.
And like, then the car comes to a halt as everyone inside suffocates to
yeah,
death.
Yeah, exactly right.
Before you get to the poison cloud.
Then you die. Like, how much air is enough air? Like, to
five.
Live on. Like, if you sealed me in a car.
Five.
About
a normal
worth.
SUV. Is it a weekend? Am I living?
No way. Mm-hmm. In an SUV?
I'm saying airtight.
Yeah, no way.
No?
You could not last a weekend.
I think it depends if you're asleep or not.
Let's assume, like, just a normal day. Start off awake, then fall asleep.
Let's say,
do I use more when I'm asleep or less?
You use less, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Use less.
It also depends on the how high up you are in elevation, because there's more...
Let's just ballpark this, guys.
Sea
this
level.
Is a hypothetical.
You would use way less.
Sea level, noon on a Saturday. I'm well rested from the night before.
Is it a vacuum?
What does it mean? Is it a vacuum? It's airtight. It's airtight.
It's air-sealed. I bet you couldn't last a day.
Oh, you're full of it.
In an SUV?
And you die of what? Carbon dioxide poisoning?
Well, right. You would take the cubic amount of air, right? And then every breath is a certain amount. And then every breath in, you take like 21% of the oxygen.
Is it 21%? Right. You breathe out a significant amount of oxygen.
Oxygen is 21% of the atmosphere, right. And you take... six or seven.
We went through this in The Martian.
Yeah, they did. He caused a big problem for himself by breathing out one point. Spoiler. Did you see the movie?
I've not seen the movie yet.
I saw it.
Did you like it?
I liked it.
Have you read the book?
Yes.
Okay, so as someone who read the book, you'd like the movie?
Yes.
What's the... You're doing the point that's the only gonna thing, refute the only, yourself.
Well, it's one of those things where, you know how you... When you read the book, there's a lot more... There's more science, it's denser, there's more problems.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, yeah. And so, like, I miss some of that, but I understand, like, as a movie, it's like, it's good. It's fun.
I watched the movie and I thought, this feels a bit Ridley Scott, and then it was directed by Ridley Scott.
Oh, yeah, really? I feel like the perfect way to consume that product, if you haven't consumed it yet, is probably the audiobook.
That's what I did, actually.
You did the audiobook?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, the book is even denser science-wise than the audiobook is.
Oh,
I
really?
Feel like,
yeah.
I want to really want to read the book.
I think it is.
The audiobook's unabridged, though.
Well, there's a lot of parentheticals in the book. Because I got the book after I got the audiobook. But either way... I think the audiobook's great.
Yeah, then you get like was not good. Okay,
I haven't seen it.
Oh
no, neither Gus nor I have seen it.
I thought visually it was very nice, and I like that we're at the point in movies where you could just totally buy it. It's like I'm not even thinking how they got those shots. I'm just like, oh yeah, he was Mars. On Mars.
Yeah,
makes and obviously they just went to some red desert, probably in Africa,
or probably a green room, and shot all that stuff.
No, that's some definite sand stuff.
Is there?
Yeah.
You can put sand in a green room.
Probably the same place they shot Red Planet, to be honest. Is it the same feel?
Yeah, maybe so. We're looking for some pretty cool landscapes right now for a show that we're making. An upcoming show.
So, you know, you talked about how the Model X has that biohazard button. Basically, it just has, like, air filters that are really good at filtering out, you know, bacteria, viruses,
is that what it is?
Things in the air. Yeah.
By the way, not a fan.
Not a fan of that?
Not a fan. Not a fan of it. It's more expensive than the Model S. Did you know that?
Yeah, it's bigger.
I know, but it's like... It's,
more steel.
They're trying to get to the Model 3, which is the $35,000 version that everyone can afford, or most people can afford.
Yeah.
That's kind of the holy grail of electric vehicles. They're going the wrong direction.
Yeah,
they're
but
going
they haven't
up.
Scaled yet. They haven't finished the factory to increase their output of batteries.
Also, those gullwing doors that they have on it, that's like the big feature, the doors that go up. It's not all the doors.
It's just the back ones.
It's just the back ones.
Yeah.
That's weird to me.
So the driver door doesn't have it?
You nailed it. That's the consumer reaction right there, Gus.
So everyone's going to be climbing in through the back because it's cooler.
And clamber over the front seat. Well, in my car right now,
well, think about it. If you put like kids in the back, you don't want them opening the door and like banging the shit out of your door. So it makes sense for that.
No, it does.
Little idiots in the back.
Doesn't a door that goes like this go out just as far as a door that does this?
No, it like lifts. Like they can park like can wedge in.
Oh, so
next
they
stuff.
Slide up. They don't.
They
like,
go up. They're like hinged up. They go
and
up.
And I think
and
they
then
have
they
a sensor that could tell them how much space they have to.
Yeah,
work
Tesla
with.
Loves those fucking sensors. They're on everything.
I read a report. On the Google self-driving
you read,
cars.
Did you not read a report? What are you? You're sitting down and reading reports? What report did you read?
A news
or is that an expression that you're using?
A news report on a website. What do you call it? An article. A news article.
An article.
Okay.
Asshole.
Like breaking out a dissertation.
And he was reviewing the Google self-driving cars, and he was just complaining about how boring it was. And
no,
it's like,
I
that's
fuck
perfect.
Off. No, 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 listen. I saw one in the parking lot. A guy was, two guys were driving around in it.
Yeah.
And I stopped them, and I was like, how can I get in it? And they were like, you can't. I was like, no, I'm serious. I want to go on a ride. I was like begging them. I was like, please let me go. And they were like, ah, sorry.
I love the car was like, fuck off, creeper.
Is it NDA or something?
Huh?
You have to sign an NDA to get in?
No, he wouldn't even. He's like, I was like, who do I have to talk to get into one of these?
It's not just NDA. I mean, I'm sure the technology involved with it is very valuable technology. They don't want lots of random people observing.
Make it in a car that looks ridiculous. Then put it in like an old Volvo or
something. It drives up. It goes... And it makes like a hovercraft noise.
I contacted Google.
He
to
did
ask to Gus. Get into the car. I was gonna surprise you if they let me in, and take you with me. But they said no.
You would have been in a robot car, and they said
they're
no
being
dice.
Stored. Have you seen them? They're like
they're right
around
know,
the corner from here.
Ah, oh, man,
you can go see them. But
the guy.
Thank you though. That's really nice.
Yeah, I was gonna take you with me.
The guy
but.
In the article,
it's like halfway nice. It's not like 100%.
The experience was too boring, and the cars drove too safely.
That was a bicycle.
Isn't that exactly what you want from a car that's not being driven by someone?
Yeah.
You want it to be just
so
ordinary
Google,
and plain.
You fucked up by not letting me in your car. I'm giving you a chance right now. You can let
redeem.
Me and Chris. He will not bring his bucket.
What?
We will ride in your stupid car.
Let me and Gavin and the other one will fucking race him in the self-driving car.
So it's up to you, Google. Just get back to me.
I want one. I would absolutely get one.
Yeah?
I just hop in a car and then it drives me to work.
How that's cool kind of what that? Happens already.
If it's safe. The car makes a point itself.
You already don't drive.
I want to replicate my current experience without inconveniencing anyone else. And it's perfect.
You could do that by getting a license.
He doesn't want, Gus, he doesn't want to ruin anybody's morning. He just wants engineers to spend decades of their life perfecting the technology.
This is not just for me. There's lots of people who like it. And also, I get a lot done as a passenger or in an Uber. I do all my email on the way to work. I'm like, beep, 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 beep. I'm not going to do that if I'm driving.
Ashley and I never fight. Ever.
Asterisk.
I drive.
Where is she?
I drive everywhere. And like, she's just in the passenger seat like, having a great time. Email, you name it.
Does that piss you off?
She's doing it over there. Well, especially like, I'll start tapping on the map because we're going somewhere. And I don't know where we're going. Like yesterday, we all went to a puzzle room together. Yes. Sorry, Chris. Yeah. we all went to a puzzle room. I didn't know where the puzzle room was. So I'm like, where's this puzzle room? And I'm driving down the road. I think I hear footsteps. I don't know where she is. She's in the rock band room, I think.
Wait, is she over there?
She's practicing. Okay. But I didn't know where it was, and I made this comment. I don't know where this puzzle room is. And she goes, oh, is it in the email that they sent for it? And I'm like, yes. And so I'm at a stoplight. We get to a stoplight. So I look up the email and then we start going again. And then I start typing in the address and she goes, careful. Shouldn't be doing that while you're driving. I'm like, I agree. I'm just waiting for her to like pick up and do it as well.
Here's being someone from England and a lot blunter than Americans. Hey, can you navigate?
That's why I do that with Matt all the time. And by the way, it's always a mistake.
Why?
Because Matt Hullum is great at everything except for when he gets in a car. I don't know what happens.
I would not trust him to navigate.
What happens, Gus, when Matt gets in a car?
There's one navigation thing I would do trust him with. It's figuring out where a fucking on-ramp in LA is.
Yeah.
If you are not on the freeway and you need to get on the freeway and you know what freeway you're looking for, he can tell you how to do that.
He can tell you how to do that. But I mean, we shot on Laser Team for 40 nights. We were shooting at night in the freezing cold. Did you ever see Matt get like flustered one time? Anything like that? Didn't happen, right?
He's cool as a cute.
Solid as rock. Gus, you've ridden in a car with Matt how many times? Like maybe half a dozen times?
Maybe.
You've seen him like yelling at other drivers, them yelling back at him?
Yep.
Yeah.
Every time.
Yeah.
He gets into yelling fights with people?
But even they yell at him.
There was that one time that woman yelled at him that he had a small dick.
And she made the like, I was going to bring that up in particular.
Yeah,
but
like, you have a small dick.
Because you have a little dick to him. Yeah, that was like the same trip where Gus bolted at the Del Taco.
It was E3 2001.
Heading
was
to the so Vegas quadrant.
Yeah. The Del Taco doesn't exist anymore.
So Michael told me he's going to Vegas for the first time.
Yeah?
Yeah.
For fun or for a particular reason?
I think he's going for fun. He's just never been before.
Okay.
What do you mean?
It's like I picture someone going to Vegas for not fun.
Well, we go to conventions.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah,
well, I mean, like, did he have a specific reason? Like, oh, for a wedding or, oh, for a, a convention or, yeah.
I can honestly say I've never been to a wedding in Vegas. Sorry, I'm chewing on my food over here.
Yeah, so. I went to a wedding in Vegas.
Didn't you go to Becca's wedding?
I went to a wedding in Vegas, and it was the most surreal thing. Yeah, it was at Becca's wedding, because like we were waiting. They finished the ceremony. It was at Caesar's Palace. We finished the wedding ceremony, then we went over to like the room where the reception was. They weren't quite ready, so we had to stand in the hall.
I was supposed to go to that.
And as we're standing in the hall, Heather Graham walked by right in front of me.
Right.
I was like, oh, that's crazy. Then we go in, and later Bradley Cooper and Zach Galifianakis show up. Because I guess they were all there doing like a press junket for the Hangover 3 or 3.
3 probably.
Whatever was out. It's like, what are the fucking odds?
They crashed the wedding.
Yeah, they just like show up.
That's pretty smart doing a movie in Vegas because you could just go back there for the press. It's just like an excuse to go to Vegas over and over again for the same thing.
I'm done. I spent 8 days in a row or 9 days in a row in Vegas.
That sounds awful.
Never going back.
Heather Graham's tiny, by the way.
Completely burned me out. What?
Heather Graham's tiny.
Oh, I believe it.
I don't think she's a real person.
Why is it that whenever someone sees a celebrity in real life, they have to comment on their size?
Either up or down.
Scale.
Have you ever met somebody that like you've seen on television or anything and met them in person and they're the exact same size that you thought they would be?
You are the perfect height that I thought you were.
Have you ever had anybody tell you that at the convention game when you're signing anything? Like, oh, you're the same size I thought you would be.
People?
No, people say I was a lot shorter and a lot taller. And my nose was a lot bigger and a lot smaller. And it looks in the life.
People always comment that I'm a lot taller than they expect.
Well, I think all the original guys get that because we're all, like, I mean, Jeff and Matt are right about 6 feet, right?
Yeah, we're all, like, above 6 feet, basically.
Yeah, and so, and Nathan was 6'5", so it's like, and Joel as well, so like, all of us appeared together, and nobody realized how tall we all were. We
Joel's
all just,
not 6'5".
No, Nathan's 6'5", Joel is 6'2". Joel's like 6'1", 6'2"?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
So we're all up there.
Yeah.
Here, let me read this.
He's 62.
What is average height?
Let me read this.
I think average height is like 5'9".
Yeah, for a guy, 5'9", 5'10".
I'm gonna read this.
Hey Gus, let me ask you.
I want to remind everyone: this episode of the Rooster Teeth podcast is brought to you by Braintree. Developers around the world have embraced the Braintree V.0 SDK as the easiest way to add secure mobile payments to their apps and websites. No matter what the payment type, Braintree accepts it. What? It's over here. Apple Pay, Android Pay, PayPal, Venmo, credit cards, even Bitcoin. And if something new pops up, Braintree will support that too. It's the same payment solution used by Uber, Airbnb, and GitHub, so you know that it scales. Braintree has simple, secure payments. Code you can integrate in minutes, and developers, they got you. Don't worry about taking days to integrate your payments. With Braintree, it's done in minutes. Integrating it into your app is as easy as inserting a few lines of code. Try out the sandbox and see for yourself at braintreepayments.com/roosterteeth.
Do it.
braintreepayments.com/roosterteeth. Start accepting money.
Just do it. There's no reason not to accept money.
Just do it.
No reason
just
at all.
Just do it.
That always leads to good stuff if you just take money.
We did that many years ago.
I told the story, by the way, when I was at the University of Nebraska this last week about our early PayPal system. And everyone in the audience said they had never heard the story before about when we turned it on for the first time. And
we've told that story
a billion times.
Many
right?
times.
Ka-ching. Yeah.
Those people don't listen to the podcast.
Probably not. Where every story
we're
gets
not
sold
big in Nebraska.
What's that?
What?
He went to do a talk in Nebraska.
Yeah. Oh, this is actually
How
the last.
How does that have anything to do with what I said?
You said what? We're not big in Nebraska. That has everything to do with what you said.
No, I mean, why are you telling me he was there? I know he was there.
What? Then you told me I was.
No.
Gavin's a...
You're wrong.
How am I wrong?
You're just wrong.
Gavin, what are you trying to say?
I was making a joke. Oh, we're not big in Nebraska?
So anyway, Gus. I went to Nebraska.
And then you got confused, but there's nothing to be confused about.
Here's the good part about it. That's my like, as soon as I got back from Lincoln, Nebraska, which there is, and Austin suffers from the same thing. There is not a direct flight in the world that goes to Lincoln, Nebraska. You had to connect from everywhere to go to Lincoln. And when I got back and stepped off the plane in Austin to, by the way, some gorgeous weather that we are having right now in Austin. When I got back, I realized, I looked at my calendar. I'm not going anywhere. I have like my calendar's like wide open at this point. I have nothing in the month of October. I'm not going anywhere. I'm just going to be here.
I believe you. You're going to absolutely go somewhere in October.
Yeah, Andy said that to me too. He's like, "You're fine. You're fine. You'll be on a plane tomorrow."
I'm not telling you that you have to. All right.
Hey, see, yeah, he is. He's bossy. He's type A. The yeah. So I'm sure something will come up, but that's going to be, I think, my last speaking engagement I do for a very long time, like very long time.
Why?
Because I did a lot of them for a long time. Like last year when we were getting ready for Laser Team and, you know, we were doing the deal with Full Screen and everything, I was in like basically on a speaking tour of like just kind of one of the problems we always dealt with for years and years at Rooster Teeth, and we're still not over it yet, is that people always like tell us how big we are, how big the audience is. Like they're like, a lot of people don't realize that. You know what I mean? We have a huge audience and a lot of people watch our content, but it's like in the industry as a whole, like we have to go and convince video game companies, right, you know, that we have a lot of gamers that watch our stuff and you should get us, not even just like, not even advertise with us, just get us a free copy of the game. You know what I mean?
I'm so mad today.
It's crazy sometimes.
So mad.
Yeah. And wow. then you get furious when you see like other people with.
I saw Greg Miller had Yoshi's Woolly World and he did a fucking unboxing earlier and I'm sitting here with nothing. Greg Miller. Who the fuck is that?
These are the kind of conversation we have a lot, by the way, is when you see anybody else on social media with something that you don't have, you're like, what the fuck is wrong with this? What's? It seems like such an injustice in the world.
I've never felt that way.
You're full of shit.
I've never seen someone with something before me and gone, damn it.
Let me get to me eventually. Let me tell you something else. If they did a collection of people where they were featuring different artists from YouTube and you were not in that collection of people that was featured, you wouldn't have a thing, something to say about that?
I might make a little snarky comment, but there's tons of YouTubers. Why would I be in everything?
Well, okay, the snarky comment's what I'm talking about. He's not going home and cutting himself. he just wants a copy of the fucking game, Gavin. You're taking that too seriously, I guess. Yeah. But it is a thing we talk about. Like, when somebody, like if there was a GameStop commercial and they put somebody on it, and it's like, we're like, what the fuck? Why didn't we get that? How come nobody talked to us about that? What the fuck?
Yeah.
You know? That's the way artists are. We just get like real like
getting your own head.
Yeah, getting your own head a little bit. That's a good way to put it.
I feel like we've been.
Hey, you want the other half of this thing?
We've
no,
been in enough
are you trying
stuff.
To kill me?
Why would I try to kill you? It's rations. You're going to live. Survival
rations.
You made
fun of me for eating a day's worth of food, and are you offering me a half day?
There's only 200 calories. There's another 100 calories right here.
Half day. I'll eat it later. A half day today.
Okay. You can have all these, Chris. Now that I've opened it, okay, I'm not going to eat it again.
Did you hear about that pilot?
Yes.
Pilot died mid-flight.
Phoenix, red eye from Phoenix to Boston. Yeah. Pilot died.
Did they say how?
How did he die?
No, they didn't say. And they didn't say whether or not he died in the air or once they were on the ground. They landed. They had to divert to Syracuse.
Do you think the co-pilot who has to take over if the pilot dies is like trying extra hard not to die?
Yeah, I would think so. He's like locked in, it's right? Like,
I'm now the
keep
only
living.
Pilot on this plane.
Yeah, you want, so,
did they say how old he is?
I don't think they really.
Does it matter now?
Well, it's like if he died and he was 28, then that's like that's weirder.
Yeah,
you know.
So I wonder in that case if, like, let's say I don't know what the procedure is for this, but let's say commercial flight, this flight, pilot becomes incapacitated, he can no longer perform his duties. What do they do with him? Do they have to bring a flight attendant to come
Ooh,
in
that's
and
a good
sit
question.
in the pilot seat, or where do they put the pilot? Do they put him on the ground?
That's probably like a cupboard.
No, something. Yeah.
A cupboard?
Here's how they solve that problem.
That's a lot
problem.
Of wasted space.
I can tell you how they solve that problem. Eject. That's what they do. Just they fire him out. That's
I imagine they would just prop him up in one of the bogs and lock it.
God.
What?
No.
I'd guarantee they don't do that.
There's, I know on international flights that some of the airlines have places to store bodies if they
yes.
die.
I believe Singapore Airlines has that on the A380.
I believe you are correct.
That's probably more comfortable than a seat, to be honest.
But also on intercontinental flights like that, there are crew quarters.
Yeah.
Like there's a little space with beds for the crew to sleep. But still, it's like, so then assuming they move the pilot somewhere else, the incapacitated pilot, can you imagine the pressure on that other person who has to take his seat? Even if they're not doing anything, it's like they just have to sit there and not fuck anything up. Like just sit there.
In a chair that someone just died in.
Right, and don't touch anything. Just if someone tells you to flip a switch, you flip a switch.
But why wouldn't they just keep him in the chair, thinking about it?
Because I think they need to have two people in the cockpit.
Well, it's like a self-driving car. You got to have somebody at the wheel ready to grab it.
Well, I mean, the co-pilot's at the controls. The other person's
not
just
the co-pilot
there.
Anymore. Got a promotion.
Okay, the pilot, newly promoted pilot, is controlling the plane. The other person's just waiting, right?
Well,
so just stand behind the dead pilot.
I think it's one of those things, too, where it's like, it's a safety thing where it's like he's falling asleep and he's shaking.
Behind the pilot? Like in your lap? Like you're Patrick Swayze making a clay pot and ghost? Like that kind of a thing?
You're not like reaching around him, controlling anything. Just stood waiting. You're waiting for the next pilot to biff it.
All I think is like that would be so intense for the one pilot. It's like you got like, this is why you have it. You have double the amount of people you need to fly the plane. In case something goes wrong. Something goes wrong, you no longer have double the amount of people you need to fly the plane.
Right, that, so you got to get someone else in there.
No, it'll be super tense, though, for that one person. Oh, who is the other jackass that's going to take over for the pilot? You're going to get, like, the head flight attendant or some dude from first class?
Probably a flight attendant. When a pilot goes to the lavatory, they have to have a flight attendant walk into the cockpit.
There's never one person.
It's like a safety thing. Yeah, yeah, because they could lock the door and then go.
Right.
Like the Air Egypt guy did, right? Was it Air Egypt?
You think it was German Wings more recently.
Is that what it was?
Yeah.
Okay. Air Egypt was the guy. They were actually both were in the cockpit.
They were fighting each other. Yes.
Yikes. What a nightmare situation
that
is. What
an enclosed space for a scuffle.
Have you ever heard about that? I may have talked about it a few weeks ago. That FedEx flight where a FedEx employee got onto the plane. He said, you know, he asked for a ride.
Oh, with
from
a hammer?
Memphis. Yeah, and he tried to kill the crew.
Yeah.
And they got into a fight in the cockpit. Yeah, he took a hammer in and a spear gun and tried to kill them.
A spear gun?
Yeah, he hit the two pilots in the head with the hammer.
Was he just like in the bag opening FedEx packages? He's like, a spear gun, yes. Let's do this.
Then turned on like the flight engineer and like they just ended up fighting. And I've seen pictures of the plane and it's just, and the pilot eventually regains consciousness and like starts doing like barrel rolls and shit.
Barrel rolls, yeah, that'll fuck
it's
up.
A movie.
There's just blood all over the place.
So who, no, excuse me, who was the guy fighting the crew?
He was also a FedEx employee.
So you just got like disgruntled employee.
Yeah, he was.
You gotta be seriously disgruntled to start beating the shit out of a pilot that is flying the plane that you're in.
He was trying to insurance his family, right?
Right, he was trying to.
He was trying to die.
He was trying to make it look like, that's why he took a hammer, because it would look like blunt force trauma, and that they wouldn't be able to tell that anything had happened, and it would just look like they died in the crash.
Oh shit, that's such an asshole thing to do.
That's mega asshole.
Man.
That's pretty bad.
So yeah, there was air disasters about it recently.
Oh,
it was pretty good.
it must suck to wake up from like a concussion knockout and try and fly a plane. and then try and kill someone,
and then
spinning it around.
You can see that if you go online and you look up those people in those slingshot rides, and then you know it's like the bungee reverse bungee where they like pull the pod down and there's two people sitting in the pod and they let it go and it fires up. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
That ride?
And they land on a net or something?
No, they just stay connected to things and they bounce up and down for a little bit.
Oh, this is not like the release thing.
They put the tether and they pull them back. Yeah, they're not like shooting them like a catapult or anything like that. But they just spring up and down. But it goes a really high distance. And a lot of people pass out on it. But the ride lasts about a minute and a half of bouncing back and forth up and down. And there's always a camera right there, too. So you see the person pass out. And then, inevitably, after the G-forces subside, they wake up, and they're in midair, and they always freak out and, like, grab the handles. Like, what would it mean to wake up on that ride?
And it's, I wonder if you would dream in between.
My favorite is the assholes who all run that ride. Will do things like they'll throw a bolt out under the guys, like, right before they get released, and be like, and then so they hear something fall, and they're like looking around. The guy walks up, like, "Oh, here it is! It just fell off." And then they, they release him and let him go up into the air.
It's like the guys who like throw a loose bit of rope off after a bungee jump.
Yeah.
Like, oh shit!
Seems dangerous too. I mean, it's like, why would you put anything like someone's gonna like throw off their form or anything like that? I just did that recently. Did that indoor skydiving?
Yeah.
Did you really?
Yeah, I did it. Ashley and I went and did it the 2 weeks ago.
You guys are like a bunch of teenagers in love, like with all your little activities that you do. Puzzle rooms and this skydiving.
Yeah, we've been having fun.
You went to the puzzle room too. You can't make fun of him for that.
Yeah, but I was invited.
You still went.
Yeah.
It was still an activity you participated in.
Thank you for going, by the way.
It was fun.
I can't believe I got both of you to one thing.
I was blown away when I saw you in there.
It was fun.
I almost pulled the hermit trifecta. I almost got Ryan to go. He dropped out last minute because he couldn't get a sitter.
You didn't almost get Ryan to go.
I know. He was never going.
Oh, there you go. Look.
See, we have 9 people, but you're allowed to have 10. That was fun.
Well, that looks fun.
Oh, sorry, Chris.
we only have space for one more person. Sorry.
Yeah, sorry, Chris. We didn't have room for you. We just have space for a person. But Barbara didn't invite me the last time I talked about puzzle rooms and told her. And didn't you go on that trip?
I did go on the last one.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, we saw your picture there.
Yeah. Looked like fun.
We did good, except for the last...
We did the same place. You guys did the villain one.
Everyone complained about the exact same thing about your run.
Yeah, I bet.
We had...
Somebody got bossy?
Ours was like a Harry Potter knockoff. It was Wizard School.
Of course, Blaine was ruining the presentation of it for the poor lady. Because it was all like non-Harry Potter stuff, and he was like, is that like Dumbledore? So you guys having a good time.
Where are you in that?
What do you mean, where is he?
I'm the one on top of everyone.
He says very dumb.
Honestly, you were so like flamboyant, I just ignored it. I was looking for like someone more quiet.
That's a lot of fun. So speaking of Federal Express, going back a little bit, I recently found out why American Express is called American Express. It started off as a postal service, as a parcel service.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that.
And then it evolved and became, I think, the first credit card?
I was thinking of American Eagle.
Sorry. The clothing company?
Yeah, I was like, huh, they went from,
is that more interesting?
I don't know. It's
that a clothing company?
To me, it's a little more interesting.
American Eagle was a clothing company?
It is.
American Eagle Outfitters.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
When he said American Eagle, I thought about the airline, but I used my Chris brain engage, and I go, he thinks it's a clothing company.
So there's American Eagle and American Apparel?
Eagle Outfitters is like a, it's kind of like a Gap for people who... Just like think Gap's like too formal, I guess. I don't know what American Eagle Outfitters is.
Beachwear?
Patrick, how would you describe? Is that an accurate description?
Meh.
Today's podcast is brought to you by American Eagle Outfitters. Do you like flannel?
I'm having a fucking hell of a time with stupid Wi-Fi.
It used to be, they used to sell, what did they do? American Express or whatever?
They were a postal service.
They were a postal service. Parcel service.
Parcel service, there you go.
So that's why they were called that. I also want to point out to you, now that we're in October, I want to point out, I try to do this as a public service announcement every October. Halloween is coming up, and this is your yearly reminder that never in the history of the United States, and probably the entire world, but definitely the United States, never has there ever been a recorded instance of someone poisoning Halloween candy. It has never happened.
But every time you mention it, I feel like someone's going to do it.
I know. When you say it like that, it sounds like a challenge.
It's not a challenge. It's not a challenge.
Put laxative in.
It's just this like mass delusion that everybody has that we're not safe. It's literally never happened.
Chris.
The only thing that could be close to being qualified for that is a guy poisoned his own nephew's, or maybe it's not a nephew, maybe his son's candy, because the guy was an idiot, took out like a $40,000 insurance policy on a kid, and then 2 days later poisoned the candy. and gave it to him.
To kill
what
him?
What kind of candy was it?
Yeah, to kill him, Gavin. What do you think it was? Like a vomit insurance policy? Oh, my kid threw up. Pay up, motherfuckers.
It's liquid gold.
Yeah, but never, honestly, never a recorded instance of anyone poisoning Halloween candy and handing it out to strangers. That's never, ever happened.
Did you hear about the Minecraft streamer?
Oh, God.
Burnt his apartment.
Was that what the Japanese guy was?
I saw that video.
Yeah, he was messing with something.
He got an oil lighter as a gift, and he was showing it off on his webcam to his
Did he get it from
stream.
One of the viewers?
I don't know who he got where
I'm going to buy those for all my favorite streamers.
he filled it with oil, lit it, and
it just like exploded in his hand.
It basically started two fires. It started a fire
for him. That's the big mistake.
Look at that bag to the left.
To a bag of tissue.
And then he takes the bag of tissue into the corner and throws cardboard boxes
on
it.
I'll smother it with cardboard.
It's like I just got to say, streaming pro tip. If you're going to be on camera, move the enormous bag of used tissues just a little bit off camera, just for everybody's sake.
That's a lot of specimen.
Yeah, yeah. So he burned down his apartment with his...
He burned down...
Bag of clear
so everyone's, everyone's giving him shit for like the way he handled this, and I'm sure he was panicked. But surely in like panic situations, you just do like raw instinct. And his instinct was to put cardboard boxes over it.
Maybe the fire hypnotized him. It was like a god to him.
What
was,
a
like,
dipshit.
Did anyone die?
Yes, one person died.
One person died?
No, somebody died
someone
in that?
Died from that?
Yeah, it burned three different apartment buildings. Multiple people had to go to the hospital, and one of his neighbors died.
Oh my god, I didn't know that. That's really awful.
Can you imagine if they were watching the stream?
They probably would have known. They'd probably be a little more alert. That's crazy.
They'd be like, what an idiot. Where does that guy live? It's like, I had no idea. Then you're on the parking lot with the guy covered in a blanket and all soot all over your face going, I'm a huge fan, dude.
I've always bought fire extinguishers for my house. I've never had to use them. And I've always thought maybe it was a waste of money, but then I watched that like, no, I'm absolutely glad that I have fire extinguishers.
I'm pretty sure
house.
I'm fire extinguisher-less at my house. I'm pretty sure. I need to get some fire extinguishers.
I'm pretty sure everyone's fire extinguisher at home, because they're not like workplace ones. They're like mini ones, like you could fit under the sink. I'm pretty sure they're useless.
No. No.
All right.
They're still fun.
Fun or effective? Because I want a fire extinguisher to be effective.
No. Like, they're so fast.
I know in like in high school, me and my friends would get little fire extinguishers and play with them.
Oh my god. Yeah. Okay, first of all, there's basically three different kinds of fire extinguishers, and two of them are perfectly fine to play with and like, you know, you can spray at people. One is the CO2 ones, that's the big fog ones.
Yeah.
That's like the ones we had on immersion, and I made sure we tested those. The other kind is the ones that just have water in them. Those are super old school, like pressurized water. You can spray those. We used to do that in my grandmother's apartment building. Every time they replaced the fire extinguishers, we'd take them down and spray each other.
It's like a Laurel and Hardy skit.
It's that third
Stooges.
Kind, which is the chemical sand, whatever the hell that is.
The
in
foam
there.
Stuff.
That is awful. Well, I guess there are foam ones too. I consider like the CO2 ones. But no, there's this foam stuff that some of these fire extinguishers spray out, and it's like it dries out the air. I don't know how else to describe it. It like sucks every bit of moisture out of the air.
I was waiting to see which one you said was the one not to play with. And I was going to cross-reference that with the one fire extinguisher that I fired at Dan. Same one.
Was it? Was it the powder one? Yeah. That's just, and did he hack and cough for hours?
Yeah. He almost collapsed.
Yeah.
I love how you're laughing about it. He almost died.
He didn't die. He was just like, he couldn't breathe anywhere.
I've never seen a foam fire extinguisher.
Electrical fires.
Yeah?
It's like type A, type B, and type C, right?
I feel like I've seen it, but I've never encountered a foam fire extinguisher. Not that I fire a bunch of fire extinguishers, but, you know. What do those look like?
They all look the same, don't they? They just have, like, different
labels. You don't know.
It's
racist. Some of those things were, yeah.
That's not racist. It's the opposite of racist. They all look the same.
That's racist.
It's different kinds.
Different.
I'm saying all fire extinguishers
I don't
look
see
alike.
A difference between fire extinguishers. They're just all fire extinguishers.
Okay, here are the different types, and they're denoted by the band on the fire extinguisher, at least in the
UK, they're all just different colors.
In Australia and New Zealand, they do it by band on there, and then in the UK, they do it by different colors. But in the US, that's the only one that matters. There's an A in a green triangle, ordinary solid combustibles. B fire extinguisher is for flammable liquids and gases. C fire extinguisher is for energized electrical equipment. That's probably your foam one right there. Mm-hmm. And then D is for combustible metals. What's a combustible metal? Like magnesium?
Magnesium, yeah.
You say magnesium or you say some stupid British pronunciation of it?
I said magnesium.
Like magnesium. And then a K
There's a K fire extinguisher. That's for potassium, oils and fats. Would be for kitchen.
Okay.
It is K for kitchen.
It's filled with baking soda.
I don't know if the one I have is for my.
They have the. It's all a mnemonic device. A is for ash for solid combustibles. B is for barrel. I don't know what the hell that means. C is for current for electrical stuff. And then D is for combustible. D is for dynamite. I'm not spraying fucking fire extinguisher on a stick of dynamite that's lit. I'm getting the hell out of there.
Yeah, you don't really want to aggravate dynamite with force. Yeah.
That would be a fun thing to do for.
Immersion?
Maybe immersion, like light something, light a fuse and see if you could stop it from reaching the thing. Like have faux dynamite, but a real fuse.
You know what I found out? We were trying to blow up different liquids. If you take one of those firecrackers...
Who's we? The Slomo guys?
Yeah.
Slomo.
If you take one of those firecrackers and weigh it down and drop it into water, the fuse will still go. If you drop it into gasoline, it goes out.
What?
Yeah.
Wait. So you're saying if someone has a stick of dynamite...
Throw it in gasoline? Like,
quick, put it in gasoline.
Well, whatever that particular fuse was made out of, it couldn't stay ignited.
Follow-up question.
I'm sure there's a very good reason for that.
Why are you throwing firecrackers into gasoline?
Yeah, really. Well, how did you discover that?
To make an explosion. What do you think? What kind of question is that?
Is it like, you're talking about like petrol or diesel?
Petrol.
Wow. Okay.
Do you see the guy who...
That's dangerous, dude.
That's dangerous.
Do not mess around with gas and fire. Just don't do it. Small amounts are very combustible.
Have you seen our safety checks? That's true.
You are very thorough.
Yeah, I've seen it. Well, you're going to be fucking kidding me.
You laughed because Dan almost died. You were literally laughing about it a second ago.
You covered him like burning oil at one point. I remember.
We had a B-type fire extinguisher on standby.
Did you? It's for barrel.
For your B.
There was a guy at a gas station who was filling up his car, and he saw a spider, and he decided to kill the spider with a fire.
With a lighter.
Yeah.
What?
So he tried to light the spider on fire, and he did.
It was
but
right,
also his car and the gas tank.
It was like on his car next to the gas tank.
Have you not seen that video? Oh my god! And then it's on fire, and then he pulls the nozzle out.
Come on, what an idiot! Do you think at the moment it all caught fire? He was like, oh yeah.
So I think fire also kills people.
People always fuck up with that in fire. But do you remember the? I think it was in Rome when the fire. Chief was doing the was doing the demonstration, Gus, of how dangerous fire is, and he's lighting the fire in a town square, and the mayor's there, and then the canister that he's using to spray like some kind of fuel for this fire, it itself catches on fire, so he starts shaking it, and then it starts throwing fire everywhere, and then he like throws it to the side and makes an arc of fire that covers the mayor and a bunch of other people, and they all go running away. Patrick, I'll see if I can find that.
Technically, he proved his point.
Yep,
he really proved his point.
While you look that up, I want to read this.
Before we get too far away from it, and you can read that because I'm really interested in what you have to read there. But what's ironic or what's interesting to me about the Minecraft streamer who lit his house on fire, the very first video I ever saw from Minecraft was the dude in the game
lit his house on fire. Yeah.
And that's how I first learned about that game. I thought, that game looks like fun. Mm. I was like, why is that a big deal? Did he find all that stuff and build that house himself? Be like, yeah. It's like, oh, what an idiot. I gotta play this game.
Right. It was totally like, it could have been real life.
All right. I want to remind everyone, this episode of the podcast is also brought to you by Dollar Shave Club. Stop shaving with an old razor. It's gross. Excuse me. Why are you torturing yourself with a gross old blade week after week? Probably because you don't want to shell out $20 for a pack of new ones. DollarShaveClub.com has DollarShaveClub.com has revolutionized the way men shave. With Dollar Shave Club, you can shave with a fresh blade as often as you want because they deliver a whole sleeve of amazing razors for just a few bucks a month. The razors are so good, millions of guys have joined. Even the billion-dollar razor companies are freaking out. Instead of lowering their bloated prices, they're trying to fool you into milking the same blade for an entire month, and that's gross. Never go back to squeezing weeks and weeks of shaves out of a disgusting, rusty blade. Join Dollar Shave Club and use a fresh blade whenever you want. It feels amazing, and it's a third of the price. Join the millions of others who figured out a smarter way to shave. Join Dollar Shave Club now by going to dollarshaveclub.com/roosterteeth. That's dollarshaveclub.com/roosterteeth. I used them extensively just the other day.
Because you shaved just the other day?
Because I shaved just the other day. It was on Friday.
I'm using mainly a razor to shave my neck, but I love Dollar Shave Club.
Why bother shaving your neck?
Disruptive company. I like that.
I've got weird hairs that grow like out of my Adam's apple, like right here.
Your Adam's apple? Serious? How come I've never noticed that?
Do a profile of that. That's foul.
It's like your nose.
Wow, that's serious.
Dude, can you make it move?
Whoa!
What is one? Like, if you were to pull one out, what does it look like?
I don't know what that is. Is it on the outside of the esophagus, or is it on the inside?
Why do we have them?
Piece of apple.
Like, what's the
and why don't
purpose?
Girls have them?
Mariel, why don't you have one?
I don't know.
Likely answer. She Let me claims look it up. To not know.
You want me to look it up? Hey, Patrick, I sent you that world's worst fire demonstration. Do you want to see it?
Yeah, let's see it. Oh. This is already bad. Oh. Where'd you say this was? This was Rome?
Oh, here you go. This is it. This is it. So he's got a canister with some fuel in it.
Oh, oh God!
Then he's like, oh, nope. Then he throws this thing. Boosh!
Oh, God!
Good Lord.
Oh, my God.
Oh,
my,
I love his reaction. Was just to chuck that thing, and he took it right into the crowd. Oh, my God.
And that's a trained professional.
Hope everybody's okay.
Yeah.
So imagine how we'd react.
What were you just talking about?
You were going to
Adam's apple.
Yeah, Adam's apples. You want to take guesses before?
Like what it is?
It's gotta be something. To
I
do
think
with
it's just
cartilage. Well, making your voice deeper or something.
So if I pulled it out, would you not talk as deep?
It's a weak spot, right? I mean, that's the only reason it exists.
Okay, Adam's apple. Is it on the inside of the esophagus or the trachea or the outside?
I think it's on the outside.
I think it's on the outside too.
If it was in your esophagus,
it feels
then
like
girls would be able to eat faster. It makes sense. What?
All right, that's it. We're done. 344 episodes. That was it. You saw it right here. We experienced it together.
The Adam. Anybody want to guess what the actual official name of the Adam's apple is?
Apalia adamia.
It is the laryngeal prominence, often referred to as the Adam's apple. A feature of the human neck is the lump or protrusion that is formed by the angle of the thyroid cartilage surrounding the larynx.
Gus, your prominence looks really good today.
It's very prominent.
It looks very prominent.
I know where my larynx is.
What's a larynx?
Right, exactly. That's what I'm getting at. But it's like, I couldn't, like, if you said draw a larynx on a piece of paper, I wouldn't.
It sounds like a, like, I'd draw some sort of cat.
If that's if it's like a valve of any sort.
That would be accurate, I think, for you.
That's it.
Everything on the inside looks like a vagina.
Everything on the inside, go ahead.
Well, everything's like valve looking, isn't it? And it like breathes through and it just looks like.
Do you
like,
think, are you saying vaginas look like valves? Do you get so turned on? Like, looking at your water hose, like the little thing.
It looks like a vagina! Unbelievable!
So larynx is just the vocal cords. That's the whole shebang there?
Is it?
Oh.
Yeah, because when you lose your voice when you get laryngitis. Right? Yes, what's Gus?
That is correct. We're
breaking this down here for you.
You also lose your voice when you get hit in the head and you get knocked out.
Someone, but they don't call it laryngitis when that happens.
Someone on Twitter is saying that...
you also lose your voice when you die flying an airplane.
The Adam's apple is a secondary sexual characteristic for men.
So that's it's just secondary
for,
to what?
We know that, though.
So it's just for, like,
it's just
mating?
Secondary to what? What's our primary?
It says, the Adam's apple is a secondary sexual characteristic for men, like boobs are for women. I need some...
That's
some
a
sources.
Bad, that's not.
Or some,
yeah, I would
some
not compare this
here.
To boobs.
Yeah, I don't know any girl who thinks an Adam's apple is attractive.
You an Adam's apples, Mariel? No, she is not.
Right?
She was very quick on the answer.
Absolutely not.
Can you imagine if you had to wear like special clothes to like cover up and like hide or like show little parts of your Adam's apple?
Maybe that's why priests.
You get, like,
wear
this is
the
cleavage right here. You're like trying to show off like
dressing
just a little bit. Yeah.
So in the American South, this is according to Wikipedia. In the American South, the Adam's apple is colloquially referred to as the goozle.
Nope.
Nope. Never heard that in my life. The goozle. Oh, I just got punched in the goozle. Why do
I don't,
you think-
I don't know, doctor. My goozle's just been sore lately.
It's like you're hitting on a girl at the bar and your buddy's like, hey, goozle. Pay attention.
Goozle oozing.
I can't find, what's the primary sex characteristic of men?
I don't know.
The penis, I
the deep voice.
Oh, I got one of those, I'm okay.
Chris Damaris.
I just want to make sure I'm checking all the boxes, you know what I mean? That's what I'm saying.
You get your goozle, you get
your penis. Google.
You gotta make sure your goozle looks good, make sure your penis looks good.
Goozle.
It is weird that how like an attractive thing on a girl can be the emission of something.
Go
right?
on.
Like.
Wait. Attractive something on a girl can be an emission.
Okay, no, I'm sorry, I was looking at goozle.
An omission of something. Okay,
emission.
Totally different. I thought it was emission. I was okay.
No, I don't think the lack of an Adam's apple is attractive.
No, but like a girl's smooth neck is attractive. And like a girl's lack of penis, even though there's not, you're not seeing anything.
It's all valves.
You just can see that there's no penis there is attractive, isn't it? As a straight man.
Yeah.
What?
So it's a, so let's say you're, you meet
you could
somebody
say
new.
A penis is a lack of vagina. It's all your frame of reference. No, that's what
penis,
I'm laughing at.
A penis is external and it like bulges through jeans. But the lack of that is attractive to me.
But you could also, what about, what, no, no, but it works the opposite way. The boobs are the increase of a chest versus
right.
the lack.
Like, there you go, the, yes, very good.
Yeah, there you go, Gav.
There you go, there Gav, you go. That's your perfect woman. There's nothing going on down there.
The lack of everything.
But you can slide but your dick like, between those
that?
Legs, no problem.
What is that?
It's a Barbie.
Like, is that a Barbie? Put that back up again. Look at the distance between her thighs for a Barbie. I never really got the whole, like, I mean, I'm sure they measured the proportions of Barbie mm-hmm. and thought it was ridiculous. But I can see it there. That's absolutely ridiculous.
Also, that waist to hip ratio is crazy.
Well, that's what they always say, but I guess I've just seen so many, like, ridiculous cartoons and stuff that, like, and I've seen, like, women in, like, corsets, like, mm-hmm. real women in those, and I've seen that on her person. That's ridiculous, though. That looks like somebody with a hip condition, that her legs are so far apart.
So you don't know what I'm talking about.
Wait, the lack of a penis but, is what makes a woman attractive? I think we're all
no,
going
I mean,
along.
No, just like the physical look of that.
But what about boobs?
Oh.
Boobs are the...
Do you think about that every time you're attracted to a woman? Is that what you think, though? Or do you think that's an attractive woman? Or do you walk up to ladies and go, hey, nice no dick? Is
that what you... Hey, baby, I noticed you got nothing down there.
Good help, but notice you don't have a penis because I looked at your pants.
I think,
and I happen to find that very attractive.
I think I'm not wrong, but I don't know how to explain it.
What you're saying is that
it makes total sense to me, though.
You're saying that you find something attractive due to its absence of something.
That's exactly what I'm saying.
Yeah, like something is attractive because it doesn't have something. Whereas normally you don't know, like, you don't think a kitten is cute because it doesn't have. Horns, you know what I mean? It's like that kind of thing.
So people are clarifying that secondary sex characteristics aren't necessarily attractive. It's just that they appear after puberty.
So oh. hair as well, I guess.
Right.
So wait, probably, so you don't get your Adam's apple until after puberty?
I think I guess.
Really?
Mm. Yeah, it comes in hard.
So Chris's thing about the deep voice might have something to do with it.
And also someone else is saying that both males and females actually have Adam's apples, but they're just more prominent in males.
Oh, what a bummer. Because everybody thinks that's like an indication that somebody's a dude. And I'm sure there's a lot of ladies out there who have a prominent Adam's apple. Because it actually physically, anatomically exists in women. Right? Is that what you're seeing there?
That's what they're saying,
yeah. It
just
yeah. doesn't bulge out.
Well, huh. it's
prominence.
Like man nipples.
It's not a prominence. It's not a laryngeal prominence. It's
a goozle.
It's a goozle.
Goozle. Yeah, there's quite a few people saying that, actually.
So that's interesting. That's got to be a pain in the ass. I wonder if, like, you were a person who had a prominent Adam's apple, a lady, could you get that reduced in some way?
Mm. Well, have it, like,
that'd
chipped
be tough,
away.
Though, because it's your neck, man.
Like, yeah. They don't do a lot of plastic surgery on necks, do they? No? I'm looking at my neck now. I'm plastering my neck.
Like, what would you have done?
I think people, like,
I got a good neck.
Like, George old Lucas people sometimes have, like, that loose skin, like, tightened up, right?
Yo, I saw a picture of Michael Moore the other day, like, I'm an Irish dude. I'm like half Irish. So Irish people tend to wear a lot of weight in their face anyway, and I've got that in my family. But if I got to the point where I got like the big like George Lucas thing or what Michael Moore's got now, I would have to do something about that, I think. I would have to do something about that.
It would just be annoying
yes,
to like...
Yes, Mega Peach, I read your tweet.
I think oh. it would be annoying to spill stuff on your neck.
If it was big?
Like when you like miss with food and it just goes down your chin, it's like... Yeah, see... If he, like, spilt food, it would go on his neck.
Ooh.
Ooh. I'm reading Twitter. Gus and I are both reading Twitter.
No, we were looking at Michael
No, Moore. That's not even, yeah. like, this is the recent one with his Where to Invade Next. He's reached a whole new level. Speaking of new levels, Twitter service got a new CEO. They got Jack is now their CEO.
Jack Dorsey?
I think Jack Petillo hates that guy.
I would imagine Jack Petillo doesn't like him either because he's never going to get the Twitter handle Jack. Ever, because one of the founders of Twitter and now the CEO of Twitter is named Jack. But I saw this and I've always wanted to talk about this on the podcast. This is one of the dumbest things I've ever seen on Twitter. And this happened, I don't even know what the dates are. Do you know the dates on that thing, Patrick? On that picture that picture I sent you? Did you get that picture I sent you about from Twitter?
He's looking for it. I see it. Nothing yet.
Oh, shit. I sent it before the podcast.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, podcast.
Yeah, so this exchange happened July of last year. July of this year. 24th of July this year. So
2015.
This guy was made the CEO of Twitter. And Chris, we're going to role play here in a second, so okay. Get ready. And the Kim Kardashian, or Kim Kardashian West, as she is known now, she made the following tweet. And you read Kim Kardashian, and I'll read Jack. Before he was CEO.
Okay. I just emailed Twitter to see if they can add an edit feature so that when you misspell something, you didn't have to delete and repost. Let's see.
Period. He replies, at Kim Kardashian, great idea. We're always looking at ways to make things faster and easier. You're fucking kidding me. 9 years that service has existed? And they're just like, he's going to say publicly, that's their first discovery of a fucking edit feature? Is that Kim Kardashian brought it up?
Great idea.
You can edit text. What a fucking phenomenal idea.
You could tell he just wanted to talk to Kim Kardashian.
You know that's exactly it. By the way,
did she misspell? How do you spell misspell?
I believe she spelled it correctly.
Is it two S's?
Yeah. I think so.
Okay. Misspell. Yeah. You're making me second guess myself. Yeah.
It just looks funny from here for some reason.
I also wish it would tell you, like, on everybody's tweet, like, a little number at the bottom, like, how many characters they used.
Why?
Because she put a U in there, like the letter U, instead of spelling out U.
Oh, so you're wondering if she was scrambling for characters.
Yeah, was she? Or it wasn't, like, that wasn't really necessary. The really aggravating thing about that is her tweet about, like, thinking about an edit feature. What a deep thought that was to think of, wow, we can edit text. That has 61,000 favorites and 30,000 retweets, Gavin.
That's an engaged group of followers.
Dude, that's unbelievable. That is a lot. That's a lot of engagement on Twitter.
I see a lot of people with many followers who will, you know, make a tweet and just really get nothing. You know, like very small engagement.
They say it's one of the best indications of people who have like bought followers. And I don't know how you do that. I guess you just go like pay a service. But, you know, I always figure if you do that, they'll just, like, cull them out anyway or something like that. But, yeah, you can look at, like, the number of people that favorite a tweet versus the number of people that actually follow the person. Like, there's people that have, like, millions of followers. They'll put up a post, and it's, like, two people favorite it. It's kind of strange.
Yeah.
Yeah. High bot level.
Yeah. I see it a lot. I'm always wary of that. You know, like you say, people can buy followers or buy social media following. Like, how many people throw money into various social media things just to try to inflate themselves and get free copies of games that I didn't get, Greg Miller?
I appreciate you have more Twitter followers than Greg Miller, right?
I do.
You should. Yeah, you deserve them. He doesn't deserve them. You deserve them, Gus.
I deserve them.
You do. You deserve them. Hey, I want you to tell me something.
He hit me in the head with a bottle.
Do you tell that story on the RTX podcast? Give me the rest of my little Lambus bread.
Oh, yeah.
Stop eating that stuff.
No, I want to. Shut up.
Don't you have a photo shoot coming up?
Yeah, no kidding. The CAPTCHA. I understand what a CAPTCHA is, and I understand what it does. Except I keep running into a CAPTCHA in a place where I don't understand why they have CAPTCHA there.
Plane Wi-Fi? Let me guess. Yeah. Let me guess. Buying Wi-Fi on a plane.
Why the fuck
is there a CAPTCHA there?
Why is there a CAPTCHA on a Wi-Fi on a plane? Why does that exist?
Would they be running bots to buy Wi-Fi? Like, who wouldn't be human trying to buy Wi-Fi?
It's on the payment page.
Yeah.
It's on the payment page. After you pay, then you type in the CAPTCHA, then you get access.
It made me not want to buy the Wi-Fi. I was like, who do you think?
I'm glad I'm not the only person that this bothers.
It's by far the most bizarre place to see one of those.
Yeah.
We should explain it better. We haven't explained it really, have we?
Well, when you log on to use Wi-Fi on a plane, they ask you account information, like your address and your credit card information.
You
do all that,
you buy it.
It's like $8 to have Wi-Fi on a domestic flight. Then it comes up and says, hey, here's a CAPTCHA. Type it in. It's always five letters. And you just type it in, and then you say, okay, now you can have access. But it's a whole different step that it makes you go through after you've paid for the service. Like, want to make sure that you're a human on a plane.
Yeah. It's only like,
after you've already paid.
Yeah.
There's only a couple hundred people who can possibly be doing that.
Or let's just say somebody's like gets into first class, they have a fucking laptop, they set it up, it's got 80 bots on it that all log on to the Wi-Fi in the plane. Why would they want to stop that? Like, what's that person doing? Like, is it just they just put it in because they feel like they have to?
But it's on the payment page. So it's like, do they want to stop 80 bots from paying?
That's what I'm saying.
Just let it happen.
What's the behavior that they're preventing there with the CAPTCHA?
Nothing. There's nothing. Nothing I can think of.
There's got to be somebody who's asked
this
question.
I've thought about this before.
It's weird because you're in a captive, like, you're in a position where it's like you're waiting for your Wi-Fi to connect. Like, why am I doing this? I don't have to do this CAPTCHA thing on anything else.
Any other internet you
connect
to.
In a hotel, where I'm convinced every node in a hotel is like a Russian hacker set it up. I'm convinced of that. And yet there's still no captchas on
free
any of that
Wi-Fi.
Yeah. No.
I'll always use a hard line. I will look in my room and I will find an Ethernet cable and I will always
Do you have a Thunderbolt to Ethernet?
Sometimes they don't have them.
In fact.
I used to do that. I used to go through all the trouble.
I've got it right here.
Why is that in your pocket?
I had to use it earlier.
I have one too. I have one in my bag.
Are you really glad I asked you if I had that today?
What a weird coincidence. Yeah, I travel with that everywhere.
But how
and I also have a VPN service I use. So I connect, then immediately VPN.
Just for no reason, just other than to...
I'm convinced everyone's trying to steal my
They can
shit.
Steal it through a VPN.
Yeah, it's a lot harder, though.
If they're between like someone who has one and doesn't, they're like, well, screw this guy. We'll go to the next person.
Right.
Yeah.
I just don't see how wired is safer than Wi-Fi.
Wi-Fi just broadcasts your shit out to everywhere. Anyone can listen to it. Especially if it's an open Wi-Fi with no password.
Yeah, it's rare though in an airport. I mean,
a hotel. They're almost all open. Like you put up, like there's no, what I'm saying, no password to connect into the network.
Oh, right. But there's like a later step.
Right.
Oh, okay. That's like a
later step to get access.
Hey, Patreon got hacked. All everybody's information gone. Boop.
So people who donated their information.
Hey, everybody, if you have an account on Patreon, everything's been hacked. Thanks, Greg Miller.
I'm sure it's his fault.
Patreon.com/kindoffunny.
Is that like who's like the leader of Patreon? Like who has the most money
Mr.
coming in?
Oh.
Like who is?
Jack Conti. That's the guy who started. The Pamplemousse guy started Patreon.
Really?
You know that?
I didn't know that.
The bearded skinny dude from Pamplemousse is one of the founders of Patreon. Huh. Bet you didn't know that.
I did not know that.
No
there you
idea.
Go.
How Jack did you
know
that?
Know what Pamplemousse
Kim
is,
Kardashian so. Told him it was a good idea. So she's in tight with all the Jacks.
Pamplemousse is that like cute girl and the way she sings.
Natalie. Dawn? Is that her name? Natalie? Natalie spelled with a Y? Yeah, and then Jack Conti, yeah. I'm a big fan of Pamplemousse. Their early stuff.
They do lots of cool... I haven't heard much original stuff.
I admit I'm a typical shithead fan where I haven't kept up in a little while, but I will go catch up on this stuff. So,
I feel like...
They make
whoa!
I feel like everyone's heard of them. For example. But I feel like loads of people have heard of them. Like loads of just sort of regular people, not even nerds, have heard of them.
Yes, Natalie Dawn. Fucking nailed it. Fucking nailed it. Natalie Dawn and Jack Conti. Let me see if Patreon Jack Conti. He's probably one of the early guys, but not the only guy.
People are saying
a lot of money in that, by the way.
Do they take what? A
lot of money in that.
By being on Patreon?
Indiegogo makes a lot of money. We did very well with our crowdfunding campaign. Made a lot of money
from
that.
You mean like they take a large slice?
Take a percentage.
What percentage does a Patreon take?
I don't know. I don't know.
Patreon.
I've been told...
Like, everyone knows what YouTube take.
No, I know. You're not supposed to talk about it, actually.
But it's like you just sign up and they tell you, don't they?
Yeah, but I think the idea is that you can like negotiate different rates and stuff like that, too, depending on what you do. But I will say that the common thing that people say is if you're going to do anything crowdfunded, whether it's, you know, Indiegogo, Kickstarter, Patreon, that you should like take the number, whatever you have, and knock like anywhere between 10 and 20% out of it completely. Mm. And really somewhere between 15 and 20% because of credit cards take money, the service takes money, and then the biggest thing that nobody really knows about is the number of declines that you get from credit cards. And you get tons of declines from those services. People are like, oh, fuck, look at that. They're going to reboot Shenmue? $1,000. Then
because
40 days later,
it.
They're like, rent's due. Oh, my credit card charge didn't go through. I'm not going to go bother with that. Like, they're not going to follow up to, like, make sure they get adequate
because
payment information.
Because they charge it later.
Yeah. Well, it depends on the model. One of the things I liked about Indiegogo is they charge the moment you do it.
That makes sense. Like, that's like...
Kickstarter charges at the end, like, one big batch. There's a drawback to that, though. I did a lot of studying of crowdfunding in the last year. I don't know if you know that. So, the drawback is that if you charge right away, then people's, like, it takes the money from their account, and they've made their commitment, and it's all good. It works the way it should. The benefit of waiting to charge everything until the end of the campaign is that you can then modify the campaign as you go and add items in. We just went through fulfillment of a lot of the physical goods for the Laser Team campaign. And like the challenge coin was one of the ones I keep people seeing tweet to me. That was something we had to add in just as a separate unit because we couldn't add it into packages. Like we couldn't like layer it in and say, oh, if you want the challenge coin, just contribute another $20 to the campaign and we'll do it or something like that. We had to add it in as a separate level. And people had to make multiple donations instead of just upping their pledge. So that's the way it works.
Someone is saying that the CAPTCHA is probably to prevent people from saying they didn't intend to pay for Wi-Fi. If you put your credit card in, I think you're... pretty much a 1080.
Yeah, it's a, I mean, it, yeah. But it's a good that the person's got a good rationale. That could be the reason for it.
But you don't do that anywhere else. You buy stuff. Like Amazon doesn't ask you for it. Yeah. Oh, I added it to cart and I pressed purchase. Whoops, didn't want to. Doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, I don't know.
Conti, is a multi-instrumentalist, songwriter, entrepreneur, and filmmaker based in the San Francisco Bay Area who lives off the sales of MP3s online. Conti has recorded 2 EPs, names of the EPs, and released them along with the compilation Video Songs Volume 1 through the iTunes Store. Conti is also the co-founder of Patreon.
I love that that's mentioned last.
Also, by the way, he put out 2 albums. He's also the founder of Patreon. So, there you go.
Here, I got one more thing to read. This one's about us. This episode of the podcast is sponsored by Rock Band 4, the only music rhythm game with a full band experience. Be sure to tune into our live stream to celebrate Rock Band 4 Day, Tuesday the 6th from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. Central Time. To be on the Rooster Teeth YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/roosterteeth. The breadth of music found on Rock Band 4 is so much more fun. Pre-order now and receive 30 bonus songs using the link below. It's a bit.ly link. Remember to tune in to watch some of your favorite Rooster Teeth faces on Tuesday the 6th, which is tomorrow if you're watching the live stream. If this is on audio, it's tonight. So Tuesday the 6th from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. We're going to be doing a live stream with Rock Band 4. And you can pre-order and get 30 bonus songs. Seems like a good deal.
Rock Band 4 is awesome, but Greg Miller thinks Rock Band 5 is way better.
Greg Miller.
Patreon.com/kindoffunnygames.
I didn't get a chance to talk about this last week when I was talking about Japan, but I did something really cool there. I do something I don't like, where it's like I'm really cynical about a lot of things, and I'm really jaded. And I feel like that's not healthy, right? Don't choke, Bernie, please. I know you.
I almost choked when you said that.
Did you just realize that?
I know it. But I know it's not a healthy thing to be.
I love the idea of you being like, oh, shit.
It's really rare that, like, I'm genuinely a fan of something. And there's some Japanese YouTubers I'm really a huge fan of. And I got a chance to meet them while I was out there. They're the guys who did the hamburger challenge.
Oh, my God. I saw your photos of this, and I knew you were in heaven.
The wheel. I'm wearing their shirt. And they're the guys who took me to the horse restaurant to eat horse.
Had they heard of you?
Yeah, they've heard of Rooster Teeth, so it was really cool.
The world is so international now.
They asked if I wanted to do a challenge with them, you know, film a video. But as I didn't have nearly enough time while I was there, so we didn't get to film anything. But I told them that they should come to Austin, and and that we should film something.
I'm right here, but I'm way too busy. So just come all the way to where I live.
They want to do it.
Oh yeah,
all right. So we'll see if we can get them out here. They were awesome. It was really really.
Can you
great
imagine
to meet them.
Taking 3 dudes from Japan and like feeding them Austin cuisine for a weekend, like make them go through that challenge they went through? Because I mean, they were doing it with American fast food, which is like, okay, it's decadent, but actually I think fast food is like it's meant to be like you tear through it pretty fast. Yeah. But like if we did that same thing with them at the Salt Lake and Rudy's, you know, and a bunch of barbecue places.
Yeah, they did. But the downside is they did barbecue in Australia for some reason. They did a barbecue challenge, so I told them
no, barbecue's huge in Australia.
Yeah, we could maybe do tacos here or something.
Yeah, in fact, it's one of the few places I think that they call it barbecue, besides America.
What do they call it elsewhere?
What do they call it in
like
the
grilling?
UK?
Grilling?
Just meat?
Yeah.
What do they call it in the UK?
Like, yeah. The event itself is called a barbecue. Like, yeah, I'm going to a barbecue.
Yeah, we have that in the UK.
Like, the barbecue is the party, but the actual act of it is grilling.
Well, you have a barbecue, and then you cook stuff on it.
Where's Ashley when you need her?
Okay.
You have, like,
Ashley,
I mean,
come
the English barbecue is, all right, it's not great. It's just, like, sausages and hamburgers and stuff.
Sausages and hamburgers?
Ashley! Let's see if she comes.
Text her.
I can't remember where my phone is.
You got your laptop right there.
It was beeping. Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
You can fucking text from that.
You've also got an Apple Watch on.
Yeah,
just
I was
going to
say, can
that.
You use your watch?
No, I don't want to find my phone because I don't know if you noticed that my phone was vibrating earlier. And Gus was like, it was like spider sense. Gus was like, he was looking for
it. I was looking for it.
It buzzed one more time. I knew he was going to lose his shit.
Ping it right now.
Let me see.
This is actually, by the way,
this is probably the most useful feature of the Apple Watch. Where is my watch? Where's my phone, Apple Watch? Oop.
I mean,
it's under my leg.
You didn't feel it vibrating under your own leg?
I don't know where it is. It's under my pillow? What the fuck is this thing?
Stand up. You can stand up.
I don't want to stand up.
Just keep pressing it. I don't know why you would stop pressing it.
What happened?
Just press it again.
Press it till you find it.
Am I on my phone?
You don't have to. It's
in
like,
my pocket.
Oh my God.
It's in my pocket.
Got my phone.
Technically, it was under your leg.
How fucking loose are your pants? You put it in your pocket and not feel it?
I worry about that. So it's even on, by the way. It's even like nuts out. All right. This is not going to be worth it to find out of what barbecue is called in Australia.
Pop another shrimp on the barbie.
Fuck a duck.
All right, let's find out.
Someone was talking the other day, I think it was on Reddit, about how they call shrimps prawns in Australia.
Yeah, yeah, and that's why they think that's bullshit, that saying.
Yeah, it was a tourism slogan.
What's the slogan?
Wait. A slogan. A tourism slogan.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we call them prawns, like king prawns and stuff. Yeah.
You want to piss Gavin off?
Don't put your phone... Okay. It's going to start humming.
Send a text to my girlfriend. Can you come in here for a second?
Ready to send it?
Yes.
I've got one of those Alexa things. No, the Echo things.
Oh, it's great.
Why would that piss Gavin off?
Oh, because it's like it never, like, you should try and read text from him. They're just gobbledygook.
Oh, you know what? What pisses Gavin off when you said prawns and shrimps, it reminds you that Gavin's pet peeve with his own channel is when you spell it slummo, guys. Like, people leave off the W on a, not just a regular basis.
Well,
it is the preferred spelling of slummo, guys.
That's how you spell slow-mo, is S-L-O-M-O. It just didn't look good when I wrote it down.
Slow-mo.
I'd rather have slow.
Slummo.
The word slow.
Right.
But, like, everyone calls it slummo, even Apple. Like
slummo.
Like, when you go into slummo mode. Yeah, look, record slummo.
Whenever, like, there's, like, a freeze frame, too, of, like, Gavin and Dan... Like, and they're like, you know, when you stop at, like, midstream and the face ends up like this? I always say, slamo, guys. Because that's what it reminds me of every time I see it.
Well, what annoys me more than that is every video I put up, people comment, you're shooting at this massive high frame rate. Why didn't you upload it at 60 frames per second? It's annoying.
Okay.
Because it makes the slow-mo much faster.
Right.
All I get from the camera is stills.
What's up? Hey, Ash. Hi. So Ash is here. What do they call when you go to a place where people are grilling and eating food? What is that called in Australia?
Barbecue.
Barbecue. See, they call it the same thing. So it's we're talking about barbecue is like one of the few places. Barbecue, like, we call that in the U.S. and then they also call it that in Australia.
You
like,
actually over just to say barbecue?
Yeah,
did I interrupt you
from doing something? Were you doing something important?
I was working on the concert.
Oh, she's working on the... We're doing a big thing for tomorrow for Rock Band 4, which we just talked about. And Ashley's been doing the run of show for that tomorrow.
Looking forward to it. We're gonna have
six set list, yo.
We're gonna have
fun.
Six set list.
Sick.
Are
you on one of the bands?
Can I say?
Yeah.
Yes, I am.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Who's in your band?
Can I say?
Come on, it's promotions.
Blaine, Miles, and Barbara.
You just didn't even. Where was I on the list? If you needed like 12 band
members? I didn't organize.
Okay.
I got approached by Megan Castro asking if I would do it, and I got assigned to a team.
Okay. I'm not on a band, and I'm like, you know, I wonder why.
You can still show up. You can take my place.
I'll show up. Why'd you fuck like a groupie?
Why'd you get left out?
I'll show up. What's that?
Why'd you get left out so much?
I knew I had to get left out a lot.
I think it's because people assume you're busy, which you are busy.
Which people will say to me, Chris, they will walk up and go, that's like, I'll be like in my office staring at the wall. Someone goes, hey man, I know you're really busy, but can I talk to you? We're out of money in the checking account. It's like, that's okay. You can tell me about stuff like this. I'm not too busy to talk about the business or anything like that.
So,
no, I think it's like, do you think about this? When you worked at Waitrose.
Yeah.
That was your last job. When you worked in the film stuff and you're like, oh man, what a hard day at the film place, you know? Yeah. The set.
Long days. Film place.
Actually
the studio we went to the most was Film Place.
Film Place.
Film Place, London.
Iconic.
And you shot the movie thing.
Yeah.
And you did that. You did that for 16 hours. And it's like...
Starring actor.
I just want to go out and get a beer. Or like rap or whatever. You would never think...
Get a pint.
I'm going to call my boss and ask my boss to go out for a drink with me. Because that's what you're getting away from. You're getting away from that. Did you ever, the entire time you worked for that guy, ask him to go out for dinner or to a movie or to drinks?
No.
It just doesn't work that way. It just doesn't work that way.
Like, I guess maybe I see you wrong.
If ever I want to like do something with a group of people, it's I have to organize it. In fact, I dealt with this just recently because I went to the Streamies with Ash and Meg and Gavin and Kovic and Bruce Green. And we were there, and I forget what it was, but we were going somewhere. And we were not going to make any progress unless I moved us. And then it was like even a point in time where you guys were all huddled up. We were going to go to dinner or something like that. And I got pulled away and was talking to somebody for like 5 or 10 minutes. I came back to the group and I'm like, do we have reservations? And I was like, I don't know, do we? It's like, so it's like I had to call for reservations. Got pulled away again. I said, we have reservations at this time. I went back to another conversation with somebody else, got pulled away, talked and talked and talked, and then came back, and it was like nobody had moved. So it's like I become like this weird, like, de facto organizer, and I don't want to be. I don't want to be. Gus can vouch for this. Yeah, I refuse to organize.
If we're all you're bad there,
in personal stuff.
If we're all
I refuse.
There because of your company, we're not going to go and have dinner without you. What does that mean? What do
or
you mean?
Just like when I'm done with the conversation, I came back and nobody had like made any progress on moving us forward in any way. Like, we would
right, well, it's like navigating all over again.
I have an excuse, and it's valid. I was drunk.
Yep, you were pretty drunk.
It's always your excuse.
But so, I think
that's for night, though.
It was fun. I just think that, well, I invite you to stuff, right? I don't really organize anything, to be honest.
I've never been to your house. And you're moving, from what I understand.
What?
So Mr. Charles Casey has maybe the best tweet of the night.
Okay.
Yeah.
The best feature of the Apple Watch, making you look like an idiot.
Yeah, that was pretty fucking good.
So thanks, Mr.
What
Charles
time
Casey.
Is it? It's idiot o'clock.
Oh my God, they updated it. I was just going to sound so douchey because I've got an Apple Watch. They updated it to allow the ability to reply to emails. And it says, sent from my Apple Watch.
Oh, yeah, you sent me one.
You sent
day.
Me one of those.
Yeah,
you
I
sent
literally, me one. I selected the what was it? The replies that are already on there. Yeah. It just said yes, and I sent it. And then it put yes. Sent from my Apple Watch. It's like yelling, I'm a douchebag.
Yeah.
From the email.
Why couldn't you respond to emails before now?
You know, he could. It just didn't say that. It didn't
oh,
say
why
something.
Would they add
no,
that?
No, you couldn't respond to emails. You could
reply
read
to
them.
Text.
They've version 2 of the Apple Watch. You can reply to emails, and I had no idea it adds the douchebag.
I don't use the mail client.
Oh yeah.
I have a weird thing. Like I use a mail client, a very specific mail client. I don't like talking about any kind of like cloud services I use because I just don't want that out there. Like which cloud service I'm on because fucking like, Patreon gets hacked.
It's gonna get out there.
Yeah.
At some point.
Like you we all know Greg Miller has account information on Patreon. I'm just saying.
But really, just never put anything online. Never put anything bad through the internet.
Okay. You just told everybody who listens to our shows online to not put their any kind of account information online anywhere. That's a bad idea to
no,
do
that's
that.
Good
I'm, talking,
stuff,
I'm
though.
Not talking about like financial yeah. stuff. You can cancel a credit card. I'm talking about right. like dodgy anything.
Nudes.
Like yeah. secret. Nudes. Yeah, like anything. Yeah.
No, to me, it's just a hassle. Like, I just recently got. My credit card expires this month. It expires in October of 2015. And at the beginning of October, I got the new credit card. And so I have a new number now associated with the new card. And I have all my credit card numbers memorized. And so it's like I'm putting off the new card as long as I possibly can.
You actually
can.
Memorize
and I got to change everything everywhere.
I used to until the, like, I forget if it was like the Target breach or the Home Depot breach. Like, I went through Patreon? Like 3 different credit cards within 3 months. And I stopped. I was like, I can't do this anymore. I used to always memorize them just because it was faster to type.
You don't need to anymore.
I remember having a conversation with you and you're like, do you not memorize your credit cards? I was like, no.
I don't think I can memorize a 16-digit number.
It's easy.
Or is it 12?
You start with the last 4, then you work your way back. 16.
Is it 16?
Yeah. Because it's 4 groups of 4.
You're right.
All right, jackasses. I don't need help finding my glasses either. Thank you. appreciate that. People on social media are yanking at
me. What is Twitter saying tonight?
Not much. I mean, somebody's saying that in Australia, we don't just use the word barbecue as an event. We also use the way of cooking the meal. Most people do that. I think when they talk about barbecuing food, but like to call it a barbecue is like that's the thing that makes it coincide with the way we
say.
In
England, I would say we're going to have a barbecue and you probably just cook meat on an outdoor barbecue.
Yeah, barbecue is like an event. Like a lot of people in other places say cookout too.
How often do you barbecue? How often do you cook out?
I do it less so now at the new place, but I used to do it all the time at the old place. Ever since I discovered sous vide, which, by the way, if you want to do that steak challenge, I will absolutely do it next week.
We need to do a steak challenge.
Yeah. And somebody said that
why aren't we doing that?
That I said I you know. Can't overcook with sous vide.
What?
If I said you can't overcook with sous vide, I mean, it's like, it's so difficult, you can't possibly do it, you know? You what can't
is,
fuck it up.
What is it?
I've had it fucked up.
What, sous vide? You will learn next week when I make you a delicious steak.
Are we doing
just
that next
for
week?
You. I'm going to make you a delicious steak.
All right.
Chris is so happy. Before we came out tonight, Bernie was talking about how he was bringing those zombie food or whatever for us to try. And he asked me, like, do you think Chris will be willing to try it also on camera? And I think I said, yeah, it's free food. Chris will absolutely eat it. Chris is all about it.
It's also cool free food. It's like got I love stuff that has like secrets and like practical things where it's like, oh, well, this is a candy bar, but it's also made of, you know, the tongue of something. It's stories, you know?
You like
what
plot.
Candy bars made of the tongue of something?
I don't know. A tongue of
stories.
Like, just weird, like,
Chris, a tongue of stories is like a relic from D&D.
There's candy bars that have like toys in them and stuff. And like, anything.
Don't ever go work in the food industry, Chris.
I'm just saying, like, now, I love a tongue stuff of that stories. Has, like, stories. It's not just like, this is a good piece of food. This is like, this is a piece of food that when you eat it, it also turns your tongue purple.
I used to like that about toothbrushes because they used to make toothbrushes out of pig hair.
Really?
Where? Well, what? I mean, when you were alive?
No, I don't know.
So you used to like toothbrushes that didn't exist since you've been born.
I just thought it was a cool story about toothbrushes.
That is
like,
cool.
Yeah, like, it used to be the hair of pigs.
It's all bristly.
Yeah, it's funny, right? It's got like a little bit of bonus.
Yeah.
I can see what you mean. Yeah, I'm with you on this one, Chris. Yeah. Even though you told me I was wrong earlier, I'm with you.
You were wrong because it
I don't
was
think
so
I was
confusing.
Wrong.
You were, well, okay, you weren't necessarily wrong, but what you said was so confusing to everyone that it just defaulted to wrong.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Sure.
It was so confusing it defaulted to wrong.
I don't know.
No, I get it. Nobody understood it, so it defaulted. That's like, he just described Gavin's appearance on the podcast in general. He says it's so confusing that the default is wrong.
Okay.
It's like,
okay,
nobody
okay,
understands
I see,
what,
I see,
nobody
I see.
Understands what Gavin is trying to say, so he must be incorrect.
But
you actually just described Gavin perfectly. That's Gavin's full experience.
Yeah, that's accurate.
That's the Gavin-free experience. Does it?
Yeah.
Does it annoy you? I'm a little annoyed by the camera on the iPhone because in order to adjust the frame rate for your slow-mo or to adjust between HD and 4K or whatever, you can't do it in the camera.
Why? Right?
Right. You have
it's
to go through like the settings to
it's
get
the
to
same.
It.
Yeah, I mean,
there's no fucking button in the camera.
I assume they think you'll just stick with it. Like you'll always want 4K or you'll always want 1080,
right.
120 or 240, whatever.
Set it and forget it.
Yeah, but it's just like, why hide that away? You know that most people won't ever go in there and see that. Like,
yeah,
90...
but you did a picture and you accidentally set the resolution at 640 by 480. You'd be like, oh, motherfucker, why would I ever want to do this?
Well, you can't do that.
Do you ever want to take less than the maximum resolution?
Well, not for a picture, but for video, you sacrifice resolution for speed.
Right. Like, you could do 720p at 240 frames a second, 1080p at 120 frames a second, or 4K at 60 or 30.
It does 400 frames a second?
No. 240.
240
or 120.
240 or 120, okay.
Yeah.
240 at 720.
240 at 720 resolution. Yeah. That's good. 240 is pretty good.
That's why you need to get in there, is to set.
And it's normally is it normally a 30 frame per second camera? Is that what it does?
Yeah.
It does 30 and it also
does
60.
The base?
I wish you could do 25. That'd be awesome.
Let me see.
That's the PAL format.
25.
Yeah. Yeah. Because if I ever want to make a Blu-ray, every video is at the same frame rate.
Okay.
I started because the cameras I was using were UK, and we always shot 25 on TV shows. I would never adjust them because I might forget when I go back on set.
Yeah.
So I would just shoot everything at 25.
So it'll do 30 frames a second or 60 at 1080 and 4K at 30 frames a second. Then for slow-mo, it'll do 1080 at 120 or 720 at 240.
Have you noticed that the 4K is stabilized?
Yeah, it absolutely is.
It's like you can do all this and it's just like...
That's not good. Is it good?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It looks legit. I mean, I haven't messed with much
with
it.
I think stabilization is actually a really cool thing.
I mean, but 4K on a lens that's this big, it's bollocks. It's not really 4K.
Yeah?
You might as well upscale 1080. It's going to look the same.
See, I always associate, though, that smoothing, essentially, digital smoothing of, you know, shake or anything like that.
I don't think it's digital. I think there's some, like, stuff in there. Optical.
Like, you mean the lens moves around?
I think so. On the big one, on the gimbal, kind of a thing. On the plus,
that's pretty cool. Yeah. Well, I first got one of those TVs when they had that smoothing on them,
Ugh.
And I played a video game with that on, and it like took away the stereoscopic effect of turning in Halo. Like everything was perfectly clear. That was fucking weird, and I had to turn all that stuff off. I still turn all that stuff off when I get a TV.
Yeah, when I got my my most recent TV that has that smoothing, that's what it is. It's like most of my time setting it up was figuring out how to make it.
I don't know why that's the default.
Are you talking about like motion blur? Like
no. They have
like smoothing. Yeah, it's like where it does 240.
But it interpolates frames between
exactly.
frames.
Yes. Yes. Increases your frame rate basically.
Which
with interpolation.
On paper is more natural to the human eye, but in practice looks like you want to throw up.
Sure. It's just you know what it is. I'm sure like 10 years from now, 15 years from now, I will prefer 48 frames a second for movies, and I will prefer 60 frames per second for video games. I've even said in the patch like way back. Patch that I preferred 30 frames per second for a video game. People are like, what the fuck are you talking about?
No, that is lunacy.
It's just too much of a change all of a sudden.
No, I also prefer 30.
You know? Yeah. It's just
that's what happens when you're old.
Yeah, I just prefer it. Because I played for decades with it as 30 frames a second. So I just got used to it then.
No, old games are 60.
No.
No?
Yep. Back in the day, 30 was the benchmark.
But like old crap, like Super Nintendo is 60.
Well, no, we're talking like PC games.
Yeah, I'm saying like 60 frames a second for gaming isn't new. It's not like you were old when that happened.
Super Nintendo was 60 frames?
I don't, wasn't it? My Doom was not.
Doom I don't think was.
I don't
think anything 3D. I think.
Listen, I've learned when Gavin says confidence, don't immediately refute it because he probably is right. What was the first 60 FPS?
I mean, for me, it was 50.
Video game.
When I was a kid.
I looked up, I did a Google search for SNES frame rate.
60 FPS.
The SNES?
It just at the top of the search results.
So the wow. SNES was 60 frames a second.
That was the standard, I think, for that whole generation of gaming.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then obviously the hardware, like, to be cheap or to be affordable had to lag behind and they reduced the frame rate. I'm sure that was a game developer's dream moment. They were like, let's do 30. We can do like twice as much with it.
Well, it's crazy too because it's like, you know, I mean, I don't know how much like all those assets take up. If you're doing 60 frames a second, it seems like your animation cycles would have to have more frames in them in order to be believable animation, I would think.
Yeah.
Because you're programming 60 frames a second. And that would just fill up more room on those, what were very small cartridges. I heard a weird stat. Do you remember what it was, Gus, where the original Sonic the Hedgehog cartridge, one on the Genesis.
Oh, you're talking about the Sega.
The Sega. When you turn it on, it went Sega like that. That took up like 1/5 of the overall cartridge. Just that voice file took it up. Do you remember? Did you ever hear that?
Yeah, that's crazy. Wow,
it's a ludicrous because it was just no storage, and they had like they were having real like captured voice played back or synthesized voice.
Because that was really cool at the time.
It was.
But even on 60 frames, I don't think they had to animate for 60 frames. The sprite could be however animated as you wanted it to be, but it would move around at 60 frames. So you could only have 5 frames of animation,
but so that's why you
move
didn't,
around
didn't,
with the sensitivity of a 60 frames game.
So it didn't really look 60 like 60 now.
No, it's mega smooth. Yeah. Like you could tell side by side,
1/8 of the cartridge space.
So yeah, that's crazy.
Not every game necessarily ran at 60. Like I was reading, Star Fox actually ran at 19 frames a second.
Yeah, because it was all 3D polygons.
Right.
And stuff.
It was just
everything 3D was never 60.
No, I don't think so.
That was it.
It's 1/8 of the space.
I think
on the cartridge.
I lost my shit the first
time.
Why
didn't they build
that
into the console?
That's a good point. Have a chip that just does that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like first party games can grab it and go play this.
Yeah, but I just found it kind of trying to achieve 60 frames again. It's like, that's not new at all.
Yeah, but 60 frames on PCs, like that's like something that feels like that was a benchmark. It used never to be until like the mid 2000s.
Everyone was happy with 30.
Is that what it was?
Yeah, I think that's what it was. It's
well,
like,
you
and then now it's like 60s, the new benchmark.
On PC? I feel like 120
is
like...
Going back to my... is I don't like 48 frames a second in movies. I can definitely say for
sure. I agree with you on that. I think the 24 frame per second filmic look has validity.
And like people like James Cameron hate it because they hate that, you know, stereoscopic effect that happens on pans and things like that. I like that a lot. I don't want it to be... Something's turning because I don't think your eyes work that way. Somebody... showed this test where if you go look at yourself in a mirror,
yeah,
if you go look at yourself in a mirror and you look at something like one eye and then you look at the other eye, you won't see your eyes moving. It's just you go like that. It just seems like click, click, click. But if you have somebody else look at you doing it, they'll see your eyes moving because your brain blocks when your eyes move so that you don't see that strobing effect. You know what I mean? Or you don't have that. So it's like, I don't want to have a perfectly smooth pan, you know, because that doesn't, I don't feel like it really exists in
Did you ever do that thing
eyesight.
As a kid where you would like throw something into water and then shut your eyes so you could see the frame?
No.
So you could do what?
Well, like if you shut your eyes, you'll have like a better memory of that exact moment than if you kept your eyes open.
No, that's really interesting. Did you do that as a kid?
Yeah, all the time. Like
if I was eating
dessert and I would just like throw my spoon into the sink. As it splashed in the water, I would close my eyes and I'd remember like the way the splash.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
Because if you keep your eyes open, there's too many frames and you can't remember the exact one you want.
Gus and I were talking about this today about the way memory works.
Cool.
It's just amazing the way memory works. No, but I think it says a lot about Gavin. It's like I've always been amazed that Gavin can take slow motion footage at like 7,000 5,000 per second. Which requires so much light in order to do that. And calculating how much light a frame of film needs is like one of the hardest things to do in film. It's like, how much light do we need for the scene? Then you add 5,000 frames in a second, it really diminishes the amount of time that each individual frame spends in the light.
And so Gavin can do that, but he can also do that. What he typically shoots is something sitting there, and then that thing explodes. And I've never seen one of your things that did had like really super shitty exposure. The only thing I've ever seen that had bad exposure for you was clearly before you had the resources, you just didn't have enough lights. And it started off dark and stayed dark. But I've never seen like you have you do an explosion and it completely out the frame or anything like that. I've always been amazed by that. So to hear you say that like you used to do that as a kid, I just think that whether or not you realize it, your brain is wired for the way a camera works and the way, like, cinematically, your brain is very wired.
Yeah, Gavin, you're so great.
It's interesting. But I do a lot of weird stuff. Like, I do a lot of weird stuff I've never talked about that I was a kid and I just can't get rid of.
Like,
and
like,
I don't think anyone anywhere has done this before.
Like what?
Okay. Let's go. I'm going to sound like a lunatic.
It's the first time.
So, and I still do this. When I'm in a car and there are streetlights, they cast a shadow across the road, right? Times.
Sure.
So there's like lines on the road as you drive. In my head, I try and figure out how many car lengths will fit between two shadows of street lights.
I do stuff like that all the time.
You do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So like when I'm in a car, I'll be like tapping, and I think when the car has like gone past its own width or length, I'll start another car and I'll see if it's like three or four car widths between them. And I just can't stop doing that.
I also do that with seams in the road, like when you go do. Do in the seams in the road. You probably have better roads in the UK than what we have. Yeah. But when you hear that when you're as a kid, you know, you're bored in a car when you're a kid.
Yeah.
Or when you're an adult, like Gavin is.
Yeah, I'm like 27 and I still do that. I was probably four when I was doing that.
Yeah. It's always funny to do when people like talk about things they didn't realize that other people did it. We had a funny experience, I'll talk about it in a second, but I was like when people find out like they do something that other people do as well. Like somebody talked about one time in a forum I read about how they used to sit and look out the window when their parents were driving, and they would imagine someone running next to them, next to the car, a little man, and he would jump over everything, like the mailbox, you know, the newspaper stand, right. You know, stuff like that. And he would just imagine that person having to jump over all those obstacles. And people were freaked out.
Isn't it just weird
how I did the exact same thing?
People come up with the same crap.
We freaked a dude out one time that we went to dinner with. Did we ever tell you the story about the time we went to dinner with somebody? We started talking about sleep paralysis, which I know I've definitely talked about on the podcast before. So we just got on the topic of sleep paralysis at dinner. And I talked about like being locked in place and being awake, but not being able to move my body and how strange that was. And somebody at the table was like, I think I've had that feeling. And then I said, did you have a feeling also that somebody was in the room? And he goes, are you being serious right now? And I'm like, yeah. He goes, yes. Well, how do you know this? And I said, that's part of it. It's called hag syndrome. You have an envision that someone is pushing you down or sitting on you, like kneeling on you and staring at you while you're trapped like that. It's a common thing. It's called syndrome that comes along with it. And I looked up a photo online of like an artist rendition of that, of hag syndrome, and I showed it to him. He freaked the fuck out. Because like he hadn't thought about it in like 20 years from when he was a kid. And he said, that's exactly it. And it was something that, it's not an image he saw 20 years ago. It's just that he experienced the memory, that same thing. Yeah,
just the feeling.
And by the way, if you want to look those images up on Google Image Search, they're creepy as shit. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not going to do that.
Yeah, don't do that.
Well, it's wrap-up time.
Okay.
So.
I'll allow it.
My hair sucks today.
Your hair's different today.
I don't know what happened to your beard. It's like mush.
You got like Gavin like.
I'll tell you what I did. I showered last night.
What happened? He got upset. Did you get upset about something?
I got to set about a lot of things.
What happened though? You're like, we're super quiet here at the end.
No. I was just thinking about like wrapping up and then what we're talking about in the post show.
Oh, okay. Oh, we're doing post show.
Yeah. That's it. I'm just thinking about the next thing. That's all.
I think you're not focused
on
the
Lambus
current.
Bread.
All right. Thanks for watching, everyone. Check out our rock band stream Tuesday the 6th, 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. on the Rooster Teeth YouTube channel. And we'll see you guys next time.
If you're listening to the audio version of the podcast, it was yesterday.
Bye.